The Optimist's Creed by Christian Larson. Promise yourself to be so strong that nothing can disturb your peace of mind, to talk health, happiness, and prosperity to every person you meet, to make all your friends feel that there is something worthwhile in them, to look at the sunny side of everything and make your optimism come true, to think only of the best, to work only for the best, and to expect only the best. To be just as enthusiastic about the success of others as you are about your own. To forget the mistakes of the past and press on to the greater achievements of the future. To wear a cheerful expression at all time and give a smile to every living creature you meet. To give so much time to improving yourself that you have no time to criticize others. To be too large for worry, too noble for anger, too strong for fear, and too happy to permit the presence of trouble. To think well of yourself and to proclaim this fact to the world, not in loud word, but in great deeds. To live in the faith that the whole world is on your side, so long as you are true to the best that is in you. How to Attract Money by Joseph Murphy. Your right to be rich. It is your right to be rich. You are here to lead the abundant life and be happy, radiant, and free. You should, therefore, have all the money you need to lead a full, happy, prosperous life. There is no virtue in poverty. The latter is a mental disease, and it should be abolished from the face of the earth. You are here to grow, expand, and unfold spiritually, mentally, and materially. You have the inalienable right to fully develop and express yourself along all lines. You should surround yourself with beauty and luxury. Why be satisfied with just enough to go around when you can enjoy the riches of the infinite? In this audiobook, you will learn to make friends with money, and you will always have a surplus. Your desire to be rich is a desire for a fuller, happier, more wonderful life. It is a cosmic urge. It is good and very good. Begin to see money in its true significance as a symbol of exchange. It means to you freedom from want, beauty, luxury, abundance, and refinement. As you listen to this chapter, you are probably saying, "I want more money. I am worthy of a higher salary than I am receiving." I believe most people are inadequately compensated. One of the causes many people do not have more money is that they are silently or openly condemning it. They refer to money as filthy lucre, or love of money is the root of all evil, etc. Another reason they do not prosper is that they have a sneaky subconscious feeling there is some virtue in poverty. This subconscious pattern may be due to early childhood training, superstition, or it could be based on a false interpretation of the scriptures. There is no virtue in poverty. It is a disease like any other mental disease. If you were physically ill, you would think there was something wrong with you. You would seek help or do something about the condition at once. Likewise, if you do not have money constantly circulating in your life, there is something radically wrong with you. Money is only a symbol. It has taken many forms as a medium of exchange down through the centuries, such as salt, beads, and trinkets of various kinds. In early times, man's wealth was determined by the number of sheep or oxen he had. It is much more convenient to write a check than to carry some sheep around with you to pay your bills. God does not want you to live in a hovel or go hungry. God wants you to be happy, prosperous, and successful. God is always successful in all his undertakings, whether he makes a star or a cosmos. You may wish to take a trip around the world, study art in foreign countries, go to college, or send your children to a superior school. You certainly wish to bring your children up in lovely surroundings so that they might learn to appreciate beauty, order, symmetry, and proportion. You were born to succeed, to win, to conquer all difficulties, and have all your faculties fully developed. If there is financial lack in your life, do something about it. Get away immediately from all superstitious beliefs about money. Do not ever regard money as evil or filthy. If you do, you cause it to take wings and fly away from you, remember that you lose what you condemn. Suppose, for example, you found gold, silver, lead, copper, or iron in the ground. Would you pronounce these things evil? God pronounced all things good. The evil comes from man's darkened understanding, from his unillumined mind, from his false interpretation of life, and his misuse of divine power. Uranium, lead, or some other metal could have been used as a medium of exchange. We use paper bills, checks, etc. Surely the piece of paper is not evil, neither is the check. Physicists and scientists know today that the only difference between one metal and another is the number and rate of motion of the electrons revolving around a central nucleus. They are now changing one metal into another through a bombardment of the atoms in the powerful cyclotron. God, under certain conditions, becomes mercury. It will only be a little while until gold, silver, and other metals will be made synthetically in the chemical laboratory. I cannot imagine seeing anything evil in electrons, neutrons, protons, and isotopes. The piece of paper in your pocket is composed of electrons and protons arranged differently. Their number and rate of motion is different. That is the only way the paper differs from the silver in your pocket. Some people will say, "Oh, people kill for money. They steal for money." It has been associated with countless crimes, but that does not make it evil. A man may give another $50 to kill someone. He has misused money in using it for a destructive purpose. You can use electricity to kill someone or light the house. You can use water to quench the baby's thirst or use it to drown the child. You can use fire to warm the child or burn it to death. Another illustration would be if you brought some earth from your garden, put it in your coffee cup for breakfast. That would be your evil. Yet the earth is not evil, neither is the coffee. The earth is displaced. It belongs in your garden. Similarly, if a needle were stuck in your thumb, it would be your evil. The needle or pin belongs in the pin cushion, not in your thumb. We know the forces or the elements of nature are not evil. It depends on our use of them whether they bless or hurt us. A man said to me one time, "I am broke. I do not like money. It is the root of all evil." Love of money to the exclusion of everything else will cause you to become lopsided and unbalanced. You are here to use your power or authority wisely. Some men crave power, others crave money. If you set your heart on money and say, "That is all I want, I am going to give all my attention to amassing money, nothing else matters," you can get money and attain a fortune, but you have forgotten that you are here to lead a balanced life. Man does not live by bread alone. For example, if you belong to some cult or religious group and become fanatical about it, excluding yourself from your friends, society, and social activities, you will become unbalanced, inhibited, and frustrated. Nature insists on a balance. If all your time is devoted to external things and possessions, you will find yourself hungry for peace of mind, harmony, love, joy, or perfect health. You will find you cannot buy anything that is real. You can amass a fortune or have millions of dollars. This is not evil or bad. Love of money to the exclusion of everything else results in frustration, disappointment, and disillusionment. In that sense, it is the root of your evil. By making money your sole aim, you simply made a wrong choice. You thought that was all you wanted, but you found after all your efforts that it was not only the money you needed. What you really desired was true place, peace of mind, and abundance. You could have millions if you wanted them and still have peace of mind, harmony, perfect health, and divine expression. Everyone wants enough money and not just enough to go around. He wants abundance and to spare. He should have it. The urges, desires, and impulses we have for food, clothing, homes, better means of transportation, expression, procreation, and abundance are all God-given, divine, and good. But we may misdirect these impulses, desires, and urges, resulting in evil or negative experiences in our lives. Man does not have an evil nature. There is no evil nature in you. It is God, the universal wisdom or life, seeking expression through you. For example, A boy wants to go to college, but he does not have enough money. He sees other boys in the neighborhood going off to college and the university. His desire increases. He says to himself, "I want an education too." Such a youth may steal and embezzle money for the purpose of going to college. The desire to go to college was basically and fundamentally good. He misdirected that desire or urge by violating the laws of society, the cosmic law of harmony, or the golden rule. Then he finds himself in trouble. However, if this boy knew the laws of mind and his unqualified capacity through the use of the spiritual power to go to college, he would be free and not in jail. Who put him in jail? He placed himself there. The policeman who locked him up in prison was an instrument of the man-made laws which he violated. He first imprisoned himself in his mind by stealing and hurting others. Fear and a guilt consciousness followed. This is the prison of the mind, followed by the prison walls made of bricks and stones. Money is a symbol of God's opulence, beauty, refinement, and abundance, and it should be used wisely, judiciously, and constructively to bless humanity in countless ways. It is merely a symbol of the economic health of the nation. When your blood is circulating freely, you are healthy. When money is circulating freely in your life, you are economically healthy. When people begin to hoard money, to put it away in tin boxes, and become charged with fear, there is economic illness. The crash of 1929 was a psychological panic. It was fear seizing the minds of people everywhere. It was a sort of negative hypnotic spell. You are living in a subjective and objective world. You must not neglect the spiritual food such as peace of mind, love, beauty, harmony, joy, and laughter. Knowledge of the spiritual power is the means to the royal road to riches of all kinds, whether your desire is spiritual, mental, or material. The student of the laws of mind, or the student of the spiritual principle, believes and knows absolutely that regardless of the economic situation, stock market fluctuation, depression, strikes, war, other conditions or circumstances, he will always be amply supplied regardless of what form money may take. The reason for this is he abides in the consciousness of wealth. The student has convinced himself in his mind that wealth is forever flowing freely in his life and that there is always a divine surplus. Should there be a war tomorrow and all the student's present holdings become valueless, as the German marks did after the First World War, he would still attract wealth and be cared for regardless of the form the new currency took. Wealth is a state of consciousness. It is a mind conditioned to divine supply forever flowing. The scientific thinker looks at money or wealth like the tide. It goes out, but it always comes back. The tides never fail. Neither will man's supply when he trusts the tireless, changeless, immortal presence, which is omnipresent and flows ceaselessly. The man who knows the workings of the subconscious mind is never, therefore, worried about the economic situation, stock market panics, devaluation, or inflation of currency, since he abides in the consciousness of God's eternal supply. Such a man is always supplied and watched over by an overshadowing presence. Behold the birds of the air, for they sow not, neither do they reap. Yet your heavenly Father feedeth them. Are you not much better than they? As you consciously commune with the divine presence, claiming and knowing that it leads and guides you in all your ways, that it is a lamp unto your feet and a light on your path, you will be divinely prospered and sustained beyond your wildest dreams. Here is a simple way for you to impress your subconscious mind with the idea of constant supply or wealth. Quiet the wheels of your mind. Relax. Let go. Immobilize the attention. Get into a sleepy, drowsy, meditative state of mind. This reduces effort to the minimum. Then, in a quiet, relaxed, passive way, reflect on the following simple truths. Ask yourself, where do ideas come from? Where does wealth come from? Where did you come from? Where did your brain and your mind come from? You will be led back to the one source. You find yourself on a spiritual working basis now. It will no longer insult your intelligence to realize that wealth is a state of mind. Take this little phrase, repeat it slowly 4 or 5 minutes, 3 or 4 times a day, quietly to yourself, particularly before you go to sleep. Money is forever circulating freely in my life, and there is always a divine surplus. As you do this regularly and systematically, the idea of wealth will be conveyed to your deeper mind, and you will develop a wealth consciousness. Idle mechanical repetition will not succeed in building the consciousness of wealth. Begin to feel the truth of what you affirm. You know what you are doing and why you are doing it. You know your deeper self is responsive to what you consciously accept as true. In the beginning, people who are in financial difficulties do not get results with such affirmations as, "I am wealthy," "I am prosperous," "I am successful." Such statements may cause their conditions to get worse. The reason is the subconscious mind will only accept the dominant of two ideas or the dominant mood of feeling. When they say, "I am prosperous," their feeling of lack is greater and something within them says, "No, you are not prosperous, you are broke." The feeling of lack is dominant so that each affirmation calls forth the mood of lack and more lack becomes theirs. The way to overcome this for beginners is to affirm what the conscious and subconscious mind will agree on. Then there will be no contradiction. Our subconscious mind accepts our beliefs, feelings, convictions, and what we consciously accept as true. A man could engage the cooperation of his subconscious mind by saying, "I am prospering every day. I am growing in wealth and in wisdom every day. Every day my wealth is multiplying. I am advancing, growing, and moving forward financially." These and similar statements would not create any conflict in the mind. For instance, if a salesman has only 10 cents in his pocket, he could easily agree that he would have more tomorrow. If he sold a pair of shoes tomorrow, there is nothing within him which says his sales could not increase. He could use statements such as, "My sales are increasing every day. I am advancing and moving forward." He would find that these would sound psychologically acceptable to his mind and produce desirable fruit. The spiritually advanced student who quietly, knowingly, and feelingly says, "I am prosperous, I am successful, I am wealthy," gets wonderful results also. Why would this be true? When they think, feel, or say, "I am prosperous," they mean God is all supply or infinite riches, and what is true of God is true of them. When they say, "I am wealthy," they know God is infinite supply, the inexhaustible treasure house, and what is true of God is therefore true of them, for God is within them. Many men get wonderful results by dwelling on three abstract ideas, such as health, wealth, and success. Health is a divine reality or quality of God. Wealth is of God. It is eternal and endless. Success is of God. God is always successful in all his undertakings. The way they produce remarkable results is to stand before a mirror as they shave and repeat for 5 or 10 minutes, "Health, wealth, and success." They do not say, "I am healthy," or "I am successful." They create no opposition in their minds. They are quiet and relaxed. Thus, the mind is receptive and passive. Then they repeat these words. Amazing results follow. All they are doing is identifying with truths that are eternal, changeless, and timeless. You can develop a wealth consciousness. Put the principles enunciated and elaborated on in this audiobook to practice, and your desert will rejoice and blossom as the rose. I worked with a young boy in Australia many years ago who wanted to become a physician and surgeon, but he had no money, nor had he graduated from high school. For expenses, he used to clean out doctor's offices, wash windows, and do odd repair jobs. He told me that every night as he went to sleep, he used to see a diploma on a wall with his name in big, bold letters. He used to clean and shine the diplomas in the medical building where he worked. It was not hard for him to engrave the diploma in his mind and develop it there. I do not know how long he continued this imagining, but it must have been for some months. Results followed as he persisted. One of the doctors took a great liking to this young boy, and after training him in the art of sterilizing instruments, giving hypodermic injections, and other miscellaneous first aid work, he became a technical assistant in his office. The doctor sent him to high school and also to college at his expense. Today, this man is a prominent doctor in Montreal, Canada. He had a dream, a clear image in his mind. His wealth was in his mind. Wealth is your idea, desire, talent, urge for service, capacity to give to mankind, your ability for usefulness to society, and your love for humanity in general. This young boy operated a great law unconsciously. Trowart says, "Having seen the end, you have willed the means to the realization of the end." The end in this boy's case was to be a physician. To imagine, see, and feel the reality of being a doctor now, to live with that idea, sustain it, nourish it, and to love it until through his imagination it penetrated the layers of the subconscious, becoming a conviction, paved the way to the fulfillment of his dreams. He could have said, "I have no education. I do not know the right people. I am too old to go to school now. I have no money. It would take years and I'm not intelligent." He would then be beaten before he started. His wealth was in his use of the spiritual power within him, which responded to his thought. The means or the way in which our prayer is answered is always hidden from us, except that occasionally we may intuitively perceive a part of the process. My ways are past finding out. The ways are not known. The only thing man has to do is to imagine and accept the end in his mind and leave its unfoldment to the subjective wisdom within. Oftentimes the question is asked, "What should I do after meditating on the end and accepting my desire in consciousness?" The answer is simple. You will be compelled to do whatever is necessary for the unfoldment of your ideal. The law of the subconscious is compulsion. The law of life is action and reaction. What we do is the automatic response to our inner movements of the mind, inner feeling, and conviction. A few months ago, as I went to sleep, I imagined I was reading one of my most popular books, Magic of Faith, in French. I began to realize and imagine this book going into all French-speaking nations. For several weeks, I did this every night, falling asleep with the imaginary French edition of Magic of Faith in my hands. Just before Christmas 1954, I received a letter from a leading publisher in Paris, France, enclosing a contract drawn up, asking me to sign it, giving him permission to publish and promote abroad to all French-speaking countries the French edition of Magic of Faith. You might ask me, what did I do about the publishing of this book after prayer? I would have to say nothing. The subjective wisdom took over and brought it to pass in its own way, which was a far better way than any method I could consciously desire. All of our external movements, motions, and actions follow the inner movements of the mind. Inner action precedes all outer action. Whatever steps you take physically, or what you seem to do objectively, will all be part of a pattern which you were compelled to fulfill. Accepting the end wills the means to the realization of the end. Believe that you have it now and you shall receive it. We must cease denying our good. Realize that the only thing that keeps us from the riches that lie all around us is our mental attitude or the way we look at God, life, and the world in general. Know, believe, and act on the positive assumption that there is no reason why you cannot have, be, and do whatever you wish to accomplish through the great laws of God. Your knowledge of how your mind works is your Savior and Redeemer. Thought and feeling are your destiny. You possess everything by right of consciousness. The consciousness of health produces health. The consciousness of wealth produces wealth. The world seems to deny or oppose what you pray for. Your senses sometimes mock and laugh at you. If you say to your friend you are opening up a new business for yourself, he may proceed to give you all the reasons why you are bound to fail. If you are susceptible to his hypnotic spell, he may instill fear of failure in your mind. As you become aware of the spiritual power which is one and indivisible and responds to your thought, you will reject the darkness and ignorance of the world and know that you possess all the equipment, power, and knowledge to succeed. To walk on the royal road to riches, you must not place obstacles and impediments on the pathway of others. Neither must you be jealous or envious of others. Actually, when you entertain these negative states of mind, you are hurting and injuring yourself because you are thinking and feeling it. The suggestion, as Quimby said, you give to another, you are giving to yourself. This is the reason that the law of the golden rule is a cosmic divine law. I'm sure you have heard men say, "That fellow has a racket. He's a racketeer. He is getting money dishonestly. He is a faker. I knew him when he had nothing. He is crooked, a thief, and a swindler." If you analyze the man who talks like that, he is usually in want or suffering from some financial or physical illness. Perhaps his former college friends went up the ladder of success and excelled him. Now he is bitter and envious of their progress. In many instances, this is the cause of his downfall. Thinking negatively of these classmates and condemning their wealth causes the wealth and prosperity he is praying for to vanish and flee away. He is condemning the things he is praying for. He is praying two ways. On the one hand, he is saying, "God is prospering me." And in the next breath, silently or audibly, he is saying, "I resent that fellow's wealth." Always make it a special point to bless the other person and rejoice in his prosperity and success. When you do, you bless and prosper yourself. If you go into the bank and see your competitor across the street deposit 20 times more than you do, or you see him deposit $10,000, rejoice and be exceedingly glad to see God's abundance being manifested through one of his sons. You are then blessing and exalting what you are praying for. What you bless, you multiply. What you condemn, you lose. If you are working in a large organization and you are silently thinking and resenting the fact that you are underpaid, that you are not appreciated, and that you deserve more money and greater recognition, you are subconsciously severing your ties with that organization. You are setting a law in motion. Then the superintendent or manager says to you, "We have to let you go." You dismissed yourself. The manager was simply the instrument through which your own negative mental state was confirmed. In other words, he was a messenger telling you what you conceived as true about yourself. It was an example of the law of action and reaction. The action was the internal movement of your mind. The reaction was the response of the outer world to conform to your inner thinking. Perhaps as you listen to this, you are thinking of someone who has prospered financially by taking advantage of others, by defrauding them and selling them unsound investments and property, etc. The answer to this is obvious, because if we rob, cheat, or defraud another, we do the same to ourselves. In reality, in this case, we are actually hurting or robbing from ourselves. We are in a mood of lack in the first place, which is bound to attract loss to us. The loss may come in many ways. It may come in loss of health, prestige, peace of mind, social status, sickness in the home or in business. It may not necessarily come in loss of money. We must not be short-sighted and think that the loss has to come just in dollars and cents. Isn't it a wonderful feeling to place your head on the pillow at night and feel you are at peace with the whole world and that your heart is full of goodwill toward all? There are some people who have accumulated money the wrong way, as by tramping on others, trickery, deceit, and chicanery. What is the price? Sometimes it is mental and physical disease, guilt complexes, insomnia, or hidden fears. As one man said to me, "Yes, I rode roughshod over others. I got what I wanted, but I got cancer doing it." He realized he had attained his wealth in the wrong way. You can be wealthy and prosperous without hurting anyone. Many men are constantly robbing themselves. They steal from themselves peace of mind, health, joy, inspiration, happiness, and the laughter of God. They may say they have never stolen, but is it true? Every time we resent another or are jealous or envious of another's wealth or success, we are stealing from ourselves. There are the thieves and robbers, which Jesus cast out of the temple. Likewise, you must cast them out incisively and decisively. Do not let them live in your mind. Cut their heads off with the fire to right thought and feeling. I remember in the early days of the war, reading about a woman in Brooklyn, New York, who went around from store to store buying up all the coffee she could. She knew it was going to be rationed. She was full of fear that there would not be enough for her. She bought as much as she could and stored it in the cellar. That evening she went to church services. When she came home, burglars had broken down the door, stolen not only the coffee, but silverware, money, jewelry, and other things. This good woman said what they all say, "Why did this happen to me when I was at church? I never stole from anyone." Is this true? Was she not in the consciousness of lack and fear when she began to hoard supplies of coffee? Her mood and fear of lack was sufficient to bring about loss in her home and possessions. She did not have to put her hand on the cash register or rob a bank. Her fear of lack produced lack. This is the reason that many people who are what society calls good citizens suffer loss. They are good in the worldly sense, i.e. they pay their taxes, they obey the laws, vote regularly, and are generous to charities, but they are resentful of others' possessions, their wealth or social position. If they would like to take money when no one was looking, such an attitude is definitely and positively a state of lack and may cause the person who indulges in such mental state to attract charlatans or knaves who may swindle or cheat them in some business transaction. Before the outer thief robs us, we have first robbed ourselves. There must be an inner thief before the outer one appears. A man can have a guilt complex and be accusing himself constantly. I knew such a man. He was very honest as a teller in a bank. He never stole any money, but he had an illicit romance. He was supporting another woman and denying his family. He lived in fear that he would be discovered. A deep sense of guilt resulted. Fear follows guilt. Fear causes a contraction of the muscles and mucous membranes. Acute sinusitis developed. Medication only gave him temporary relief. I explained to this client the cause of his trouble and told him the cure was to give up his outside affair. He said he couldn't, she was his soulmate, and that he had tried. He was always condemning and accusing himself. One day he was accused by one of the officials of the bank of having embezzled some money. It looked serious for him as the evidence was circumstantial. He became panic-stricken and realized that the only reason he was wrongfully accused was that he had been accusing and condemning himself. He saw how mind operates. Inasmuch as he was always accusing himself on the inner plane, he would be accused on the outer. He broke off the relationship immediately with the other woman due to the shock of being accused of embezzling and began to pray for divine harmony and understanding between himself and the bank official. He began to claim, "There is nothing hidden that is not revealed. The peace of God reigns supreme in the minds and hearts of all concerned." Truth prevailed. The whole matter was dissolved in the light of truth. Another young man was discovered as the culprit. The bank teller knew that only through prayer was he saved from a jail sentence. The great law is, as you would that men should think about you, think you about them in the same manner. As you would that men should feel about you, feel you also about them in like manner. Say from your heart, "I wish for every man who walks the earth what I wish for myself. The sincere wish of my heart is, therefore, peace, love, joy, abundance, and God's blessings to all men everywhere. Rejoice and be glad in the progression, advancement, and prosperity of all men." Whatever you claim is true for yourself, claim it for all men everywhere. If you pray for happiness and peace of mind, let your claim be peace and happiness for all. Do not ever try and deprive another of any joy. If you do, you deprive yourself. When the ship comes in for your friend, it comes in for you also. If someone is promoted in your organization, be glad and happy. Congratulate him, rejoice in his advancement and recognition. If you are angry or resentful, you are demoting yourself. Do not try and withhold from another his God-given birthright to happiness, success, achievement, abundance, and all good things. Jesus said, "Sow up for yourselves treasures in heaven, where the moth and the rust doth not consume, and where thieves cannot break through and steal." Hatred and resentment rot and corrode the heart, causing us to become full of scars, impurities, toxins, and poisons. The treasures of heaven are the truths of God which we possess in our soul. Fill your minds with peace, harmony, faith, joy, honesty, integrity, loving kindness, and gentleness. Then you will be sowing for yourself treasures in the heavens of your own mind. If you are seeking wisdom regarding investments, or if you're worried about your stocks or bonds, quietly claim, "Infinite intelligence governs and watches over all my financial transactions, and whatsoever I do shall prosper." Do this frequently, and you will find that your investments will be wise. Moreover, you will be protected from loss as you will be prompted to sell your securities or holdings before any loss accrues to you. Let the following prayer be used daily by you regarding your home, business, and possessions. The overshadowing presence, which guides the planets on their course and causes the sun to shine, watches over all my possessions, home, business, and all things that are mine. God is my fortress and vault. All my possessions are secure in God. It is wonderful. By reminding yourself daily of this great truth and by observing the laws of love, you will always be guided, watched over, and prospered in all your ways. You will never suffer from loss, for you have chosen the Most High as your counselor and guide. The envelope of God's love surrounds, enfolds, and encompasses you at all times. You rest in the everlasting arms of God. All of us should seek an inner guidance for our problems. If you have a financial problem, repeat this before you retire at night. "Now I shall sleep in peace. I have turned this matter over to the God wisdom within. It knows only the answer. As the sun rises in the morning, so will my answer be resurrected. I know the sunrise never fails." Then go off to sleep. Do not fret, fuss, or fume over a problem. Night brings counsel. Sleep on it. Your intellect cannot solve all your problems. Pray for the light that is to come. Remember, the dawn always comes, then the shadows flee away. Let your sleep every night be a contented bliss. You are not a victim of circumstances, except you believe you are. You can rise and overcome any circumstance or condition. You will have different experiences as you stand on the rock of spiritual truth, steadfast and faithful to your deeper purposes and desires. In large stores, the management employs store detectives to prevent people from stealing. They catch a number every day trying to get something for nothing. All such people are living in the consciousness of lack and limitation, and are stealing from themselves, attracting at the same time all manner of loss. These people lack faith in God and the understanding of how their minds work. If they would pray for true place, divine expression, and supply, they would find work. Then by honesty, integrity, and perseverance, they would become a credit to themselves and society at large. Jesus said, "For ye have the poor always with you, but me ye have not always." The poor states of consciousness are always with us in this sense, that no matter how much wealth you now have, there is something you want with all your heart. It may be a problem of health. Perhaps a son or daughter needs guidance, or harmony is lacking in the home. At that moment, you are poor. We could not know what abundance was except we were conscious of lack. "I have chosen 12, and one of you is a devil." Whether it be the King of England or the boy in the slums, we are all born into limitation and into the race belief. It is through these limitations we grow. We could never discover the inner power except through problems and difficulties. These are our poor states which prod us in seeking the solution. We could not know what joy was, except we could shed a tear of sorrow. We must be aware of poverty to seek liberation and freedom and ascend into God's opulence. The poor states, such as fear, ignorance, worry, lack, and pain, are not bad when they cause you to seek the opposite. When you get into trouble and get kicked around from pillar to post, when you ask negative, heart-rending questions, such as, why are all these things happening to me? Why does there seem to be a jinx following me? Light will come into your mind. Through your suffering, pain, or misery, you will discover the truth which sets you free. Sweet are the uses of adversity, like a toad ugly and venomous, yet wears a precious jewel on its head. Through dissatisfaction, we are led to satisfaction. All those studying the laws of life have been dissatisfied with something. They have had some problem or difficulty which they could not solve, or they were not satisfied with the man-made answers to life's riddles. They have found their answer in the God presence within themselves, the pearl of great price, the precious jewel. The Bible says, I sought the Lord and I found him, and he delivered me from all my fears. When you realize your ambition or desire, you will be satisfied for only a period of brief time, then the urge to expand will come again. This is life seeking to express itself at higher levels through you. When one desire is satisfied, another comes, etc., to infinity. You are here to grow. Life is progression, it is not static. You are here to go from glory to glory. There is no end, for there is no end to God's glory. We are all poor in the sense we are forever seeking more light, wisdom, happiness, and greater joy out of life. God is infinite, and never in eternity could you exhaust the glory, beauty, and wisdom which is within. This is how wonderful you are. In the absolute state, all things are finished, but in the relative world, we must awaken to that glory which was ours before the world was. No matter how wise you are seeking more wisdom, so you are still poor. No matter how intelligent you are in the field of mathematics, physics, or astronomy, you are only scratching the surface. You are still poor. The journey is ever onward, upward, and Godward. It is really an awakening process whereby you realize creation is finished. When you know God does not have to learn, grow, expand, or unfold, you begin to gradually awaken from the dream of limitation and become alive in God. As the scales of fear, ignorance, race belief, and mass hypnosis fall from your eyes, you begin to see as God sees. The blind spots are removed. Then you begin to see the world as God made it, for we begin to see it through God's eyes. Now you say, behold, the kingdom of heaven is at hand. Feed the poor within you. Clothe the naked ideas and give them form by believing in the reality of the idea, trusting the great fabricator within to clothe it in form and objectify it. Now your word, idea, shall become flesh or take form. When you are hungry, poor states, you seek food. When worried, you seek peace. When you are sick, you seek health. When you are weak, you seek strength. Your desire for prosperity is the voice of God in you, telling you that abundance is yours. Therefore, through your poor state, you find the urge to grow, to expand, to unfold, to achieve, and to accomplish your desires. A pain in your shoulder is a blessing in disguise. It tells you to do something about it at once. If there were no pain and no indication of trouble, your arm might fall off on the street. Your pain is God's alarm system telling you to seek His peace and His healing power and move from darkness to light. When cold, you build a fire. When you are hungry, you eat. When you are in lack, enter into the mood of opulence and plenty. Imagine the end. Rejoice in it. Having imagined the end and felt it is true, you have willed the means to the realization of the end. When you are fearful and worried, feed your mind with the great truths of God that have stood the test of time and will last forever. You can receive comfort by meditating on the great Psalms. For example, "The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want." "God is my refuge, my salvation, whom shall I fear?" "God is an ever-present help in time of trouble." "My God, in Him will I trust." "He shall cover me with His feathers, and under His wings shall I rest." "One with God is a majority." "If God be for me, who can be against me?" "I do all things through Christ which strengthen me." Let the healing vibrations of these truths flood your mind and heart. Then you will crowd out of your mind all your fears, doubts, and worries through this meditative process. Imbibe another great spiritual truth. "A merry heart maketh a cheerful countenance." "A merry heart hath a continual feast." "A merry heart doeth good like a medicine. A broken spirit drieth the bones." "Therefore I put thee in remembrance, that thou stir up the gift of God within thee." Begin now to stir up the gift of God by completely rejecting the evidence of senses, the tyranny and despotism of the race mind, and give complete recognition to the spiritual power within you as the only cause, the only power, and the only presence. Know that it is a responsive and beneficent power. Draw nigh unto it, and it will draw nigh unto you. Turn to it devotedly with assurance, trust, and love. It will respond to you as love, peace, guidance, and prosperity. It will be your comforter, guide, counselor, and your heavenly Father. You will then say, "God is love. I have found Him, and He truly has delivered me from all my fears." Furthermore, you will find yourself in green pastures where abundance and all of God's riches flow freely through you. Say to yourself freely and joyously during the day, "I walk in the consciousness of the presence of God all day long. His fullness flows through me at all times, filling up all the empty vessels in my life." When you are filled full of the feeling of being what you long to be, your prayer is answered. Are all the vessels full in your life? Look under health, wealth, love, and expression. Are you fully satisfied on all levels? Is there something lacking in one of these four? All that you seek, no matter what it is, comes under one of these classifications. If you say, "All I want is truth or wisdom," you are expressing the desire of all men everywhere. That is what everyone wants, even though he or she may word it differently. Truth or wisdom is the overall desire of every man. This comes under the classification of expression. You wish to express more and more of God here and now. Through your lack, limitation, and problems, you grow in God's light and you discover yourself. There is no other way whereby you could discover yourself. If you could not use your powers two ways, you would never discover yourself, neither would you ever deduce a law governing you. If you were compelled to be good or compelled to love, that would not be love. You would then be an automaton. You have freedom to love because you can give it or retain it. If compelled to love, there is no love. Aren't you flattered when some woman tells you she loves you and wants you? She has chosen you from all the men in the world. She does not have to love you. If she were forced to love you, you would not be flattered or happy about it. You have freedom to be a murderer or a holy man. This is the reason we praise such men as Lincoln and others. They decided to choose the good. We praise them for their choice. If we believe that circumstances, conditions, events, age, race, religious training, or early environment can preclude the possibility of our attaining a happy, prosperous life, we are thieves and robbers. All that is necessary to express happiness and prosperity is to feel happy and prosperous. The feeling of wealth produces wealth. States of consciousness manifest themselves. This is why it is said, "All that ever came before me, feeling, are thieves and robbers." Feeling is the law, and the law is the feeling. Your desire for prosperity is really the promise of God saying that His riches are yours. Accept this promise without any mental reservation. Quimby likened prayer to that of a lawyer pleading the case before the judge. This teacher of the laws of mind said he could prove the defendant was not guilty as charged, but that the person was a victim of lies and false beliefs. You are the judge. You render your own verdict, then you are set free. The negative thoughts of lack, poverty, and failure are all false. They are all lies. There is nothing to back them up. You know there is only one spiritual power, one primal cause, and you therefore cease giving power to conditions, circumstances, and opinions of men. Give all power to the spiritual power within you, knowing that it will respond to your thought of abundance and prosperity. Recognizing the supremacy of the spirit within and the power of your own thought or mental image is the way to opulence, freedom, and constant supply. Accept the abundant life in your own mind. Your mental acceptance and expectancy of wealth has its own mathematics and mechanics of expression. As you enter into the mood of opulence, all things necessary for the abundant life will come to pass. You are now the judge, arriving at a decision in the courthouse of your mind. You have, like Quimby, produced indisputable evidence showing how the laws of your mind work, and you are now free from fear. You have executed and chopped the heads off all the fear and superstitious thoughts in your mind. Fear is the signal for action. It is not really bad. It tells you to move to the opposite, which is faith in God and all positive values. Let this be your daily prayer. Write it in your heart. God is the source of my supply. That supply is my supply now. His riches flow to me freely, copiously, and abundantly. I am forever conscious of my true worth. I give of my talents freely, and I am wonderfully, divinely compensated. Thank you, Father. The Road to Riches. Riches are of the mind. Let us suppose for a moment that a physician's diploma was stolen together with his office equipment. I am sure you would agree that his wealth was in his mind. He could still carry on, diagnose disease, prescribe, operate, and lecture on materia medica. Only his symbols were stolen. He could always get additional supplies. His riches were in his mental capacity, knowledge to help others, and his ability to contribute to humanity in general. You will always be wealthy when you have an intense desire to contribute to the good of mankind. Your urge for service, i.e. to give of your talents to the world, will always find a response in the heart of the universe. I knew a man in New York during the financial crisis of 1929 who lost everything he had, including his home and all his life's savings. I met him after a lecture which I had given at one of the hotels in the city. This is what he said. I lost everything. I made $1 million in 4 years. I will make it again. All I have lost is a symbol. I can again attract the symbol of wealth in the same way as honey attracts flies. I followed the career of this man for several years to discover the key to his success. The key may seem strange to you, yet it is a very old one. The name he gave the key was, Change Water into Wine. He read this passage in the Bible, and he knew it was the answer to perfect health, happiness, peace of mind, and prosperity. Wine in the Bible always means the realization of your desires, urges, plans, dreams, propositions of your desires, etc. In other words, it is the things you wish to accomplish, achieve, and bring forth. Water in the Bible usually refers to your mind or consciousness. Water takes the shape of any vessel into which it is poured. Likewise, whatever you feel and believe as true will become manifest in your world. Thus, you are always changing water into wine. The Bible was written by illumined men. It teaches practical everyday psychology and a way of life. One of the cardinal tenets of the Bible is that you determine, mold, fashion, and shape your own destiny through right thought, feeling, and beliefs. It teaches you that you can solve any problem, overcome any situation, and that you are born to succeed, to win, and to triumph. In order to discover the royal road to riches, and receive the strength and security necessary to advance in life, you must cease viewing the Bible in the traditional way. That same man who was in a financial crisis used to say to himself frequently during the days when he was without funds, "I can change water into wine." These words meant to him, "I can exchange the poverty ideas in my mind for the realization of my present desires or needs, which are wealth and financial supply." His mental attitude, water, was, "Once I made a fortune honestly, I will make it again, wine." His regular affirmation consisted of, "I attracted the symbol, money, once. I am attracting it again. I know this and feel it is true, wine." This man went to work as a salesman for a chemical organization. Ideas for the better promotion of their products came to him. He passed them on to his organization. It was not long until he became vice president. Within 4 years, the company made him president. His constant mental attitude was, "I can change water into wine." Look upon the story in John of changing water into wine in a figurative way, and say to yourself, as this chemical salesman did, "I can make the invisible ideas, urges, dreams, and desires of mine visible, because I have discovered a simple, universal law of mind." The law he demonstrated is the law of action and reaction. It means your external world, body, circumstances, environment, and financial status are always a perfect reflection of your inner thinking, beliefs, feelings, and convictions. This being true, you can now change your inner pattern of thought by dwelling on the idea of success, wealth, and peace of mind. As you busy your mind with these latter concepts, these ideas will gradually seep into your mentality like seeds planted in the ground. As all seeds, thoughts, and ideas grow after their kind, so will your habitual thinking and feeling manifest in prosperity, success, and peace of mind. Wise thought, action, is followed by right action, reaction. You can acquire riches when you become aware of the fact that prayer is a marriage feast. The feast is a psychological one. You meditate, mentally eat of, on your good or your desire until you become one with it. I will now cite a case history from my files relating how a young girl performed her first miracle in transforming water into wine. She operated a very beautiful hair salon. Her mother became ill, and she had to devote considerable time at home, neglecting her business. During her absence, two of her assistants embezzled funds. She was forced into bankruptcy, losing her home and finding herself deeply in debt. She was unable to pay hospital bills for her mother, and she was now unemployed. I explained to this woman the magic formula of changing water into wine. Again, we made it clear to her that wine means answered prayer or the objectification of her ideal. She was quarreling with the outside world. She said, "Look at the facts. I have lost everything. It is a cruel world. I cannot pay my bills. I do not pray, for I have lost hope." She was so absorbed and engrossed in the material world that she was completely oblivious to the internal cause of her situation. As we talked, she began to understand that she had to resolve the quarrel in her mind. No matter what your desire or your ideal is as you listen to this book, you will also find some thought or idea in your mind opposed to it. For example, your desire may be for health. Perhaps there are several thoughts such as these in your mind simultaneously. "I can't be healed. I have tried, but it's no use. It's getting worse. I don't know enough about spiritual mind healing." As you study yourself, don't you have a tug of war in your mind? Like this girl, you find environment and external affairs challenging your desire of expression, wealth, and peace of mind. True prayer is a mental marriage feast, and it teaches us all how to resolve the mental conflict. In prayer, you write what you believe in your own mind. Emerson said, "A man is what he thinks all day long." By your habitual thinking, you make your own mental laws of belief. By repeating a certain train of thought, you establish definite opinions and beliefs in the deeper mind called the subconscious, Then such mental acceptances, beliefs, and opinions direct and control all the outer actions. To understand this and begin to apply it is the first step in changing water into wine, or changing lack and limitation into abundance and opulence. The man who is unaware of his own inner spiritual powers is, therefore, subject to race beliefs, lack, and limitation. Open your Bible now and perform your first miracle as this beauty operator did. You can do it. If you merely read the Bible as a historical event, you will miss the spiritual, mental, scientific view of the laws of mind with which we are concerned in this audiobook. Let us take this passage. And the third day there was a marriage in Cana of Galilee, and the mother of Jesus was there. Galilee means your mind or consciousness. Cana means your desire. The marriage is purely mental, or the subjective embodiment of your desire. This whole beautiful drama of prayer is a psychological one in which all the characters are mental states, feelings, and ideas within you. One of the meanings of Jesus is illumined reason. The mother of Jesus means the feeling, moods, or emotions which possess us. And both Jesus was called and his disciples to the marriage. Your disciples are your inner powers and faculties enabling you to realize your desires. And when they wanted wine, the mother of Jesus saith unto him, they have no wine. Wine, as we have stated, represents the answered prayer or the manifestation of your desire and ideals in life. You can now see this is an everyday drama taking place in your own life. When you wish to accomplish something, as this girl did, namely finding work, supply, and a way out of your problem, suggestions of lack come to you, such as, there is no hope, all is lost, I can't accomplish it, it is hopeless. This is the voice from the outside world saying to you, they have no wine, or look at the facts. This is your feeling of lack, limitation, or bondage speaking. How do you meet the challenge of circumstances and conditions? By now you are getting acquainted with the laws of mind, which are as follows. As I think and feel inside, so is my outside world, i.e. my body, finances, environment, social position, and all phases of my external relationship to the world and man. Your internal mental movements and imagery govern, control, and direct the external plane in your life. The Bible says, as he thinketh in his heart, so is he. The heart is a Chaldean word, meaning the subconscious mind. In other words, your thought must reach subjective levels by engaging the power of your subliminal self. Thought and feeling are your destiny. Thought, charged with feeling and interest, is always subjectified and becomes manifest in your world. Prayer is a marriage of thought and feeling, or your idea and emotion. This is what the marriage feast relates. Any idea or desire of the mind felt as true comes to pass, whether it is good, bad, or indifferent. Knowing the law now that what you imagine and feel in your mind, you will express, manifest, or experience in the outside, enables you to begin to discipline your mind. When the suggestion of lack, fear, doubt, or despair, they have no wine, come to your mind, immediately reject it mentally by focusing your attention at once on the answered prayer, or the fulfillment of your desire. The statement given in the Bible from John 2, mine hour is not yet come, and woman, what have I to do with thee, are figurative, idiomatic, oriental expressions. As we paraphrase the quotation, woman means the negative feeling that you indulge in. These negative suggestions have no power of reality because there is nothing to back them up. A suggestion of lack has no power. The power is resident in your own thought and feeling. What does God mean to you? God is the name given to the one spiritual power. God is the one invisible source from which all things flow. When your thoughts are constructive and harmonious, the spiritual power being responsive to your thought flows as harmony, health, and abundance. Practice the wonderful discipline of completely rejecting every thought of lack by immediately recognizing the availability of the spiritual power and its response to your constructive thoughts and imagery. Then you will be practicing the truth found in these words, "Woman, what have I to do with thee?" We quoted, "Mine hour is not yet come." This means that while you have not yet reached a conviction or positive state of mind, you know you are on the way mentally because you are engaging your mind on the positive ideals, goals, and objectives in life. Whatever the mind dwells upon, it multiplies, magnifies, and causes it to grow until finally the mind becomes qualified with the new state of consciousness. You are then conditioned positively, here as before you were conditioned negatively. The spiritual man in prayer moves from the mood of lack to the mood of confidence, peace, and trust in the spiritual power within himself. Since his trust and faith are in the spiritual power, his mother, mood and feeling, registers a feeling of triumph or victory. This will bring about the solution or the answer to your prayer. The water pots in the story from the Bible refer to the mental cycles that man goes through in order to bring about the subjective realization of his desire. The length of time may be a moment, hour, week, or month, depending on the faith and state of consciousness of the student. In prayer, we must cleanse our mind of false beliefs, fear, doubt, and anxiety by becoming completely detached from the evidence of senses and the external world. In the peacefulness and quietude of your mind, wherein you have stilled the wheels of your mind, meditate on the joy of the answered prayer until that inner certitude comes, whereby you know that you know. When you have succeeded in being one with your desire, you have succeeded in the mental marriage or the union of your feeling with your idea. I am sure you wish to be married, one with, to health, harmony, success, and achievement in your mind at this moment. Every time you pray, you are trying to perform the marriage feast of Cana, realization of your desire or ideas. You want to be mentally identified with the concept of peace, success, well-being, and perfect health. They filled them up to the brim. The six water pots represent your own mind in the spiritual and mental creative act. You must fill your mind to the brim, meaning you must become filled full of the feeling of being what you long to be. When you succeed in filling your mind with the ideal you wish to accomplish or express, you are full to the brim. Then you cease praying about it, for you feel its reality in your mind. You know. It is a finished state of consciousness. You are at peace about it. And he saith unto them, "Draw out now and bear unto the governor of the feast." Whatever is impregnated in our subconscious mind is always objectified on the screen of space. Consequently, when we enter a state of conviction that our prayer is answered, we have given the command, "Bear unto the governor of the feast." You are always governing your mental feast. During the day, thousands of thoughts, suggestions, opinions, sights, and sounds reach your eyes and ears. You can reject them as unfit for mental consumption, or entertain them as you choose. Your conscious reasoning, intellectual mind is the governor of the feast. When you consciously choose to entertain, meditate, feast upon, and imagine your heart's desire as true, it becomes a living embodiment and a part of your mentality so that your deeper self gives birth or expression to it. In other words, what is impressed subjectively is expressed objectively. Your sense or conscious mind sees the objectification of your good. When the conscious mind becomes aware of water made into wine, it becomes aware of the answered prayer. Water might be called also the invisible, formless spiritual power, unconditioned consciousness. Wine is conditioned consciousness, or the mind giving birth to its beliefs and convictions. The servants, which draw the water for you, represent the mood of peace, confidence, and faith. According to your faith or feeling, your good is attracted or drawn to you. Imbibe, cherish, fall in love with these spiritual principles which are discussed in this audio book. In the first recorded miracle of Jesus, you are told that prayer is a marriage feast, or the mind uniting with its desire. Love is the fulfilling of the law. Love is really an emotional attachment, a sense of oneness with your good. You must be true to that which you love. You must be loyal to your purpose or to your ideal. We are not being true to the one we love when we are flirting or mentally entertaining other marriages with fear, doubt, worry, anxiety, or false beliefs. Love is a state of oneness, a state of fulfillment. When this simple drama was explained to the beauty operator mentioned about, she became rich mentally. She understood this drama, and she put it into practice in her life. This is how she prayed. She knew that the water, her own mind, would flow and fill up all the empty vessels in response to her new way of thinking and feeling. At night, this client became very quiet and still, relaxed her body, and began to use constructive imagery. The steps she used are as follows. First step. She began to imagine the local bank manager was congratulating her on her wonderful deposits in the bank. She kept imagining that for about 5 minutes. The second step. In her imagination, she heard her mother saying to her, "I am so happy about your wonderful new position." She continued to hear her say, "This is a happy, joyous way," for about 3 to 5 minutes. The third step. Vividly, she imagined the writer was in front of her, performing her marriage ceremony. "This woman heard me saying as the officiating minister, I now pronounce you man and wife." Completing this routine, she went off to sleep, feeling filled full, sensing and feeling within herself the joy of the answered prayer. Nothing happened for 3 weeks. In fact, things got much worse, but she persevered, refusing to take no for her answer. She knew that in order to grow spiritually, she too had to perform her first miracle by changing her fear to faith, her mood of lack to a mood of opulence and prosperity, by changing consciousness, water, into the conditions, circumstances, and experiences she wished to express. Consciousness, awareness, beingness, principle, spirit, or whatever name you give, it is the cause of all. It is the only presence and power. The spiritual power or spirit within us is the cause and substance of all things. All things, birds, trees, stars, sun, moon, earth, gold, silver, and platinum are its manifestations. It is the cause and substance of all things. There is none else. Understanding this, she knew that water, consciousness, could become supply in the form of money, true place, or true expression for herself, health for her mother, as well as companionship and fullness of life. She saw this simple yet profound truth in the twinkling of an eye and said to me, "I accept my good." She knew that nothing is hidden from us. All of God is within us, waiting for our discovery and inquiry. In less than a month, this young girl got married. The writer performed the ceremony. I pronounced the words she heard me say over and over again in her meditative, relaxed state. "I now pronounce you man and wife." Her husband gave her a check for $24,000 as a wedding present, as well as a trip around the world. Her new expression as a beauty operator was to beautify her home and garden, and make the desert of her mind rejoice and blossom as the rose. She changed water into wine. Water, or her consciousness, became charged or conditioned by her constant, true, happy imagery. These images, when sustained regularly, systematically, and with faith in the developing powers of the deeper mind, will come out of the darkness, subconscious mind, into light, objectified on the screen of space. There is one important rule. Do not expose this newly developed film to the shattering light of fear, doubt, despondency, and worry. Whenever worry or fear knocks at your door, immediately turn to the picture you developed in your mind and say to yourself, "A beautiful picture is being developed now in the dark house of my mind." Mentally pour on that picture your feeling of joy, faith, and understanding. You know you have operated a psychological spiritual law, for what is impressed shall be expressed. It is wonderful. The following is a sure, certain way for developing and manifesting all the material riches and supply you need all the days of your life. If you apply this formula sincerely and honestly, you should be amply rewarded on the external plane. I will illustrate this by telling you of a man who came to see me in London in desperate financial straits. He was a member of the Church of England and had studied the working of the subconscious mind to some extent. I told him to say frequently during the day, "God is the source of my supply, and all my needs are met at every moment of time and point of space." Think also of all the animal life in this world and in all the galaxies of space which are now being taken care of by an infinite intelligence. Notice how nature is lavish, extravagant, and bountiful. Think of the fish of the sea which are all being sustained, as well as the birds of the air. He began to realize that since he was born, he had been taken care of, fed by his mother, clothed by his father, and watched over by tender, loving parents. This man got a job and was paid in a wonderful way. He reasoned that it was illogical to assume that the principle of life, which gave him life and always took care of him, would suddenly cease to respond to him. He realized that he had cut off his own supply by resenting his employer, self-condemnation, criticism of himself, and by his own sense of unworthiness. He had psychologically severed the cord which joined him to the infinite source of all things, the indwelling spirit or life principle called by some consciousness or awareness. Man is not fed like the birds. He must consciously commune with the indwelling power and presence, and receive guidance, strength, vitality, and all things necessary for the fulfillment of his needs. This is the formula which he used to change water into the wine of abundance and financial success. He realized God, or the spiritual power within him, was the cause of all. Furthermore, he realized that if he could sell himself the idea that wealth was his by divine right, he would manifest abundance of supply. The affirmation he used was, "God is the source of my supply. All my financial and other needs are met at every moment of time and point of space. There is always a divine surplus." This simple statement, repeated frequently, knowingly, and intelligently, conditioned his mind to a prosperity consciousness. All he had to do was to sell himself this positive idea in the same way a good salesman has to sell himself on the merits of his product. Such a person is convinced of the integrity of his company, the high quality of the product, the good service which it will give the customer, and the fact that the price is right, etc. I told him whenever negative thoughts came to his mind, which would happen, not to fight them, quarrel with them in any way, but simply go back to the spiritual mental formula and repeat it quietly and lovingly to himself. Negative thoughts came to him in avalanches at times in the form of a flood of negativity. Each time he met them with the positive, firm, loyal conviction, "God supplies all my needs. There is a divine surplus in my life." He said as he drove his car and went through his day's routine that a host of sundry miscellaneous negative concepts crowded his mind from time to time, such as, "There is no hope. You are broke." Each time such negative thoughts came, he refused their mental admission by turning to the eternal source of wealth, health, and all things which he knew to be his own spiritual awareness. Definitely and positively he claimed, "God is the source of my supply, and that supply is mine now." Or, "There is a divine solution. God's wealth is my wealth." And other affirmative positive statements which charged his mind with hope, faith, expectancy, and ultimately a conviction in an ever-flowing fountain of riches supplying all his needs copiously, joyously, and endlessly. The negative flood of thoughts came to him as often as 50 times in an hour. Each time he refused to open the door of his mind to these gangsters, assassins, and thieves, which he knew would only rob him of peace, wealth, success, and all good things. Instead, he opened the door of his mind to the idea of God's eternal life principle of supply flowing through him as wealth, health, energy, power, and all things necessary to lead a full and happy life here. As he continued to do this, the second day not so many thieves knocked at his door. The third day, the flow of negative visitors was less. The fourth day, they came intermittently, hoping for admission but receiving the same mental response. No entrance. I accept only thoughts and concepts which activate, heal, bless, and inspire my mind. He reconditioned his consciousness or mind to a wealth consciousness. The prince of this world cometh and hath nothing in me. This conveys to your mind, the negative thoughts such as fear, lack, worry, anxiety came, but they received no response from his mind. He was now immune, God intoxicated, and seized by a divine faith in an ever-expanding consciousness of abundance and financial supply. This man did not lose everything, neither did he go into bankruptcy. He was given extended credit, his business improved, new doors opened up, and he prospered. Remember always in the prayer process, you must be loyal to your ideal, purpose, and objective. Many people fail to realize wealth and financial success because they pray two ways. They affirm God is their supply and that they are divinely prospered, but a few minutes later they deny their good by saying, I can't pay this bill. I can't afford this, that, or the other things. Or they say to themselves, a jinx is following me. I can't ever make ends meet. I never have enough to go around. All such statements are highly destructive and neutralize your positive prayers. This is what is called praying two ways. You must be faithful to your plan or your goal. You must be true to your knowledge of the spiritual power. Cease making negative marriages, i.e., uniting with negative thoughts, fears, and worries. Prayer is like a captain directing the course of his ship. You must have a destination. You must know where you are going. The captain of the ship, knowing the laws of navigation, regulates his course accordingly. If the ship is turned from its course by storms or unruly waves, he calmly redirects it along its true course. You are the captain on the bridge, and you are giving the orders in the way of thoughts, feelings, opinions, beliefs, moods, and mental tones. Keep your eye on the beam. You go where your vision is. Cease, therefore, looking at all the obstacles, delays, and impediments that would cause you to go off your course. Be definite and positive. Decide where you are going. Know that your mental attitude is the ship which will take you from the mood of lack and limitation to the mood and feeling of opulence, and to the belief in the inevitable law of good working for you. Quimby, who was a doctor, a wonderful student, and teacher of the mental and spiritual laws of mind, said, "Man acts as he is acted upon." What moves you now? What is it that determines your response to life? The answer is as follows. Your ideas, beliefs, and opinions activate your mind and condition you to the point that you become, as Quimby stated, an expression of your beliefs. This illustrates the truth of Quimby's statement, "Man is belief expressed." Another popular statement of Quimby's was, "Our minds mingle like atmospheres, and each person has his identity in that atmosphere." When you were a child, you were subject to the moods, feelings, beliefs, and general mental atmosphere of the home. The fears, anxieties, superstitions, as well as the religious faith and convictions of the parents were impressed on your mind. Let us say the child had been brought up in a poverty-stricken home in which there was never enough to go around, financially speaking. He heard constantly the complaint of lack and limitation. You could say, like Salter in his conditioned reflex therapy, that the child was conditioned to poverty. The young man may have a poverty complex based on his early experiences, training, and beliefs, but he can rise above any situation and become free. This is done through the power of prayer. I knew a young boy, age 17, who was born in a place called Hell's Kitchen in New York. He listened to some lectures I was giving in Steinway Hall, New York, at the time. This boy realized that he had been the victim of negative, destructive thinking, and that if he did not redirect his mind along constructive channels, the world mind, with its fears, failures, hates, and jealousies, would move in and control him. Man acts as he is acted upon. It stands to reason, as Quimby knew, that if man will not take charge of his own house, mind, the propaganda, false beliefs, fears, and worries of the phenomenalistic world will act as a hypnotic spell over him. We are immersed in the race mind which believes in sickness, death, misfortune, accident, failures, disease, and diverse disasters. Follow the biblical injunctions. Come out from among them then and be separate. Identify yourself mentally and emotionally with the eternal verities which have stood the test of time. This young man decided to think and plan for himself. He decided to take the royal road to riches by accepting God's abundance here and now and to fill his mind with spiritual concepts and perceptions. He knew, as he did this, he would automatically crowd out of his mind all negative patterns. He adopted a simple process called scientific imagination. He had a wonderful voice, but it was not cultivated or developed. I told him the image he gave attention to in his mind would be developed in his deeper mind and come to pass. He understood this to be a law of mind, a law of action and reaction, i.e. the response of the deeper mind to the mental picture held in the conscious mind. This young man would sit down quietly in his room at home, relax his whole body, then vividly imagine himself singing before a microphone. He would actually reach out for the feel of the instrument. He would hear me congratulate him on his wonderful contract and tell him how magnificent his voice was. By giving his attention and devotion to this mental image regularly and systematically, a deep impression was made on his subconscious mind. A short time elapsed, and an Italian voice instructor in New York gave him free lessons several times a week because he saw his possibilities. He got a contract which sent him abroad to sing in the salons of Europe, Asia, South Africa, and other places. His financial worries were over, for he also received a wonderful salary. His hidden talents and ability to release them were his real riches. These talents and posers within all of us are God-given. Let us release them. Did you ever say to yourself, "How can I be more useful to my fellow creature? How can I contribute more to humanity?" A minister friend of mine told me that in his early days, he and his church suffered financially. His technique or process was this simple prayer, which worked wonders for him. God reveals to me better ways to present the truths of God to my fellow creature. Money poured in. The mortgage was paid in a few years, and he has never worried about money since. As you listen to this chapter, you have now learned that the inner feelings, moods, and beliefs of man always control and govern his external world. The inner movements of the mind control the outer movements. To change the outside, you must change the inside. As in heaven, so on earth. Or as in my mind or consciousness, so is it in my body, circumstances, and environment. The Bible says, "There is nothing hidden that shall not be revealed." For example, if you are sick, you are revealing a mental and emotional pattern, which is the cause. If you are upset or if you receive tragic news, notice how you reveal it in your face, eyes, gestures, tonal qualities, also in your gait and posture. As a matter of fact, your whole body reveals your inner distress. You could, of course, through mental discipline and prayer, remain absolutely poised, serene, and calm, refusing to betray your hidden feelings or mental states. You could order the muscles of your body to relax, be quiet, and be still. They would have to obey you. Your eyes, face, and lips would not betray any sign of grief, anger, or despondency. On the other hand, with a little discipline through prayer and meditation, you could reverse the entire picture. Even though you had received disturbing news, regardless of its grave nature, you could show and exhibit joy, peace, relaxation, and a vibrant, buoyant nature. No one would ever know that you were the recipient of so-called bad news. Regardless of what kind of news you received today, you could go to the mirror, look at your face, lips, eyes, and your gestures as you tell yourself and imagine you have heard the news of having received a vast fortune. Dramatize it, feel it, thrill to it, and notice how your whole body responds to the inner thrill. You can reverse any situation through prayer. Busy your mind with the concepts of peace, success, wealth, and happiness. Identify yourself with these ideas mentally, emotionally, and pictorially. Get a picture of yourself as you want to be. Retain that image. Sustain it with joy, faith, and expectancy. Finally, you will succeed in experiencing its manifestation. I say to people who consult me regarding financial lack to marry wealth. Some see the point, others do not. As all Bible students know, your wife is what you are mentally joined to, united with, or at one with. In other words, what you conceive and believe, you give it conception. If you believe the world is cold, cruel, and harsh, that it is a dog-eat-dog way of life, that is your concept. You are married to it, and you will have children or issue by that marriage. The children from such a mental marriage or belief will be your experiences, conditions, and circumstances, together with all other events in your life. All your experiences and reactions to life will be the image and likeness of the ideas which fathered them. Look at the many wives the average man is living with, such as fear, doubt, anxiety, criticism, jealousy, and anger. These play havoc with his mind. Marry wealth by claiming, feeling, and believing, God supplies all my needs according to his riches in glory. Or take the following statement and repeat it over and over again, knowingly, until your consciousness is conditioned by it, or it becomes a part of your meditation. I am divinely expressed, and I have a wonderful income. Do not say this in a parrot-like fashion, but know that your train of thought is being engraved in your deeper mind, and it becomes a conditioned state of consciousness. Let the phrase become meaningful to you. Pour life, love, and feeling on it, making it alive. One of my class students recently opened a restaurant. He phoned me saying he got married to a restaurant. He meant that he had made up his mind to be very successful, diligent, and persevering, and to see that his business prospered. This man's wife, mental, was his belief in the accomplishment of his desire or wish. Identify yourself with your aim in life and cease mental marriages with criticism, self-condemnation, anger, fear, and worry. Give attention to your chosen ideal, being full of faith and confidence in the inevitable law of prosperity and success. You will accomplish nothing by loving your ideal 1 minute and denying it the next minute. This is like mixing acid and an alkali, for you will get an inert substance. In going along the royal road to riches, you must be faithful to your chosen ideal, your wife. We find illustrations in the Bible relating to these same truths. For example, Eve came out of Adam's rib. Your rib is your concept, desire, idea, plan, goal, or aim in life. Eve means the emotion, feeling, nature, or the inner tone. In other words, you must mother the idea. The idea must be mothered, loved, and felt as true in order to manifest your aim in life. The idea is the father. The emotion is the mother. This is the marriage feast, which is always taking place in your mind. Uspensky spoke of the third element which entered in or was formed following the union of your desire and feeling. He called it the neutral element. We may call it peace, for God is peace. The Bible says, "And the government shall be on his shoulders." In other words, let divine wisdom be your guide. Let the subjective wisdom within you lead guide, and govern you in all your ways. Turn over your request to this indwelling presence, knowing in your heart and soul that it will dissipate the anxiety, heal the wound, and restore your soul to equanimity and tranquility. Open your mind and heart and say, God is my pilot. He leads me. He prospers me. He is my counselor. Let your prayer be night and morning. I am a channel through which God's riches flow ceaselessly, copiously, and freely. Write that prayer in your heart. Inscribe it in your mind. Keep on the beam of God's glory. The man who does not know the inner workings of his own mind is full of burdens, anxieties, and worries, for he has not learned how to cast his burden on the indwelling presence and go free. The Zen monk was asked by his disciple, "What is truth?" He replied in a symbolic way by taking the bag off his back and placing it on the ground. The disciple then asked him, "Master, how does it work?" The Zen monk, still silent, placed the bag on his back and walked on down the road singing to himself. The bag is your burden or your problem. You cast it on the subjective wisdom which knows all and has the know-how of accomplishment. It knows only the answer. Placing the bag again on his back means, though I still have the problem, I now have mental rest and relief from the burden because I have invoked the divine wisdom on my behalf. Therefore, I sing the song of triumph, knowing that the answer to my prayer is on the way, and I sing for the joy that is set before me. It is wonderful. Every man at the beginning doth set forth good wine, and when men have well drunk, then that which is worse, but thou hast kept the good wine until now. This is true of every man when he first enters a knowledge of the laws of mind. He sets out with high spirits and ambitions. He is the new broom which sweeps clean, and he is full of good intentions. Oftentimes he forgets the source of power. He does not remain faithful to the principle within him, which is scientific and effectual, that would lift him out of his negative experiences and set him on the high road to freedom and peace of mind. He begins to indulge mentally and emotionally with ideas and thoughts extraneous to his announced aim and goal. In other words, he is not faithful to his ideal or wife. Know that the subjective or deep self within you will accept your request, and being the great fabricator, it will bring it to pass in its own way. All you do is release your request with faith and confidence, in the same way you would cast a seed on the ground or mail a letter to a friend, knowing the answer would come. Did you ever go between two great rocks and listen to the echo of your voice? This is the way the life principle within you answers. You will hear the echo of your own voice. Your voice is your inner mental movement of the mind, your inner psychological journey where you feasted mentally on an idea until you were full, then you rested. Knowing this law and how to use it, be sure you never become drunk with power, arrogance, pride, or conceit. Use the law to bless, heal, inspire, and lift up others as well as yourself. Man misuses the law by selfishly taking advantage of his fellow man. If you do, you hurt and attract loss to yourself. Power, security, and riches are not to be obtained externally. They come from the treasure house of eternity within. We should realize that the good wine is always present, for God is the eternal now. Regardless of present circumstances, you can prove your good is ever present by detaching yourself mentally from the problem, going on the high watch, and go about your Father's business. To go on the high watch is to envision your good, to dwell on the new concept of yourself, to become married to it, and sustain the happy mood by remaining faithful, full of faith every step of the way, knowing that the wine of joy, the answered prayer, is on the way. Now is the day of salvation. The kingdom of heaven is at hand. Thou hast kept the good wine until now. You can, this moment, travel psychologically in your mind and enter mentally through divine imagination into any desired state. The wealth, health, or invention you wish to introduce are all invisible first. Everything comes out of the invisible. You must subjectively possess riches before you can objectively possess wealth. The feeling of wealth produces wealth, for wealth is a state of consciousness. A state of consciousness is how you think, feel, believe, and what you mentally give consent to. A teacher in California, receiving over $5,000 or $6,000 a year, looked in a window at a beautiful ermine coat that was priced at $8,000. She said it would take me years to save that money. I could never afford it. Oh, how I want it. She listened to our lectures on Sunday mornings. By ceasing to marry these negative concepts, she learned that she could have a coat, car, or anything she wished without hurting anybody on the face of the earth. I told her to imagine she had the coat on, to feel its beautiful fur, and to get the feel of it on her. She began to use the power of her imagination prior to sleep at night. She put the imaginary coat on, fondled it, caressed it, like a child does with her doll. She continued to do this and finally felt the thrill of it all. She went to sleep every night wearing this imaginary coat and being so happy in possessing it. 3 months went by and nothing happened. She was about to waver, but she reminded herself that it is the sustained mood which demonstrates. He who perseveres to the end shall be saved. The solution will come to the person who does not waver, but always goes about with the perfume of his presence with him. The answer comes to the man who walks in the light that it is done. You are always using the perfume of his presence when you sustain the happy, joyous mood of expectancy, knowing your good is on the way. You saw it in the unseen, and you know you will see it in the seen. The sequel to the teacher's drama of the mind is interesting. One Sunday morning after our lecture, a man accidentally stepped on her toe, apologized profusely, asked her where she lived, and offered to drive her home. She accepted gladly. Shortly after, he proposed marriage, gave her a beautiful diamond ring, and said to her, "I saw the most wonderful coat. You would simply look radiant wearing it." It was the coat she admired 3 months previously. The salesman said over 100 wealthy women looked at the coat, admired it immensely, but for some reason always selected another garment. Through your capacity to choose, imagine the reality of what you have selected, and through faith and perseverance, you can realize your goal in life. All the riches of heaven are here now, within you, waiting to be released. Peace, joy, love, guidance, inspiration, goodwill, and abundance all exist now. All that is necessary in order to express God's riches is for you to leave the present now, your limitation, enter into the mental vision or picture, and in a happy, joyous mood, become one with your ideal. Having seen and felt your good in moments of high exaltation, you know that in a little while you shall see your ideal objectively as you walk through time and space. As within, so without. As above, so below. As in heaven, so on earth. In other words, you will see your beliefs expressed. Man is belief expressed. How Success Grows from Failure by Napoleon Hill. Turn back the pages of history, back to the very beginning of all that we know of civilization, and you will find that the men and women whose names lived after they passed on were those whose efforts were born of struggle, hardship, and failure. Men may leave behind them monuments of marble without struggle, hardship, and failure, but those who would build monuments in the hearts of their fellow men, where neither the disintegrating forces of the elements nor the degrading hand of man can destroy them, must pay the price in sacrifice and struggle. 10 years ago, a baby was born into one of the wealthiest families in America. The whole world showered the little fellow with gifts it did not need and could not use. One foolish king sent as his offering to the useless collection a gold crib that cost $40,000. I was going to law school in the city where that baby was born, Therefore, I know a considerable amount about the event. That bountiful shower of gifts reminded me of the passage in the Bible that reads something along these lines. To him that hath, it shall be given, and to him that hath not, it shall be taken away, even that which he hath. Nothing more true to human nature was ever said than this. Like attracts like. Wealth attracts wealth, and poverty attracts poverty. It is the way of human nature. By and by, this little baby grew old enough to be taken on the streets. When he was taken out, he was flanked by a coterie of servants and private detectives whose business it was to see that no misfortune overtook him. Never in all this baby's life was he permitted outside the protecting influence of these servants. He could not go on the street alone. He was watched over with care that would lead one to believe he might have been made of superior clay. This little fellow had no cares. He experienced no hardships. He never knew what struggle meant. All he knew was that he was not born to toil. He did not have to dress himself. He had servants for that purpose. He did not have to use his eyes. He had servants' eyes to use. He did not have to use his hands. He had servants' hands to use. In fact, he did not have to do anything. Each winter he went with his army of servants to play in the rolling waters of the warm Gulf of Mexico, where he was not bothered with the cold blizzards of the north. When he went out to swim, he was surrounded by the same army of servants who flanked him and watched to see that no harm befell him. 2 years ago, this little fellow, now a boy of 10 years, had just returned to the north from his wintering place in Florida. He was out in the gardens with his servants when he noticed that the gates were open and he saw beyond the much-longed-for freedom that every normal child is constantly seeking. While the servants' vigilance had slackened for a moment, he saw his chance and made a run for the street. He got outside and into the middle of the street when he was run down and instantly killed by a Ford automobile. At the very moment this was happening, there were no less than a million little urchins located in the crowded streets of the great cities, not one of which could have been run down by an automobile in an open 10-acre field, because these little unfortunates had learned the art of self-defense. Out of struggle, struggle born of necessity, they had learned to get out of the way of automobiles. Verily do we repeat that out of struggle and hardship come endurance and power. Servants and private detectives can watch over a baby and possibly keep him from being stolen. They can even keep him from being run down by automobiles if they attend to their duties properly. But the eternal law of compensation takes its toll when the little fellow grows up to maturity and commences to take his place among men. He pays dearly for the early protection that relieved him of struggle the very first time he is called upon to rely entirely on his own resources, because he finds that he has no real resources. The strong-armed blacksmith developed his strength out of resistance. The greater the resistance, the greater his strength. By wielding a heavy hammer day in and day out, he finally grew a mighty arm that serves him wherever physical strength is needed. He developed his strong arm in exactly the same manner that all strength must be developed, by overcoming resistance. We point with pride to Lincoln as being one of the really great Americans of the past, yet how many stop to consider that his strength, both physical and moral, grew out of hardship and struggle? No doubt Nancy Hanks would have given Lincoln as royal a birth as that of the little boy mentioned before if she had been financially able, but if she had done so, there is but little doubt that Lincoln would never have risen to the heights to which he attained. Much of Lincoln's greatness grew out of his early struggles and hardships, because out of these grew strength, that mighty strength which carried him through one of the most trying crises of this country. The most dangerous handicap with which any child could be surrounded is the handicap of money, provided it is used to relieve the child of struggle. 20-odd years ago, I was secretary to a wealthy man whose 2 sons were away at college. It was a part of my duty to make a check out for $100 for each of these boys on the first of the month. This was their spending money, and spend it they did. Well do I remember how I envied these boys the easy time this monthly remittance provided. By and by, they returned home with their sheepskins and other things too, among them being the capacity for great quantities of whiskey. One of those boys is now under the sod, and the other is in an insane asylum, a victim of DTs. Last year, I had the privilege of speaking in the college where one of the boys went to school. The principal of the school told me that the $100 check which came monthly for that boy was the influence that undermined him. With that check, he had money to be a good fellow. This led to the drink habit, and that led to ruination. I can see now that fate dealt me a lucky blow when it placed the great cosmic urge of necessity behind me in my early childhood and forced me to struggle for a schooling and for existence itself. That struggle seemed hard then, but I know now that it was the strengthening process I needed to prepare me for a man's work in life. My own boys are coming along now, and in spite of the powerful moral which I have drawn from my own experience and from my observation of the two boys mentioned, I see myself inclined to make it easy for my boys when I can. This is a common tendency, a human sort of tendency perhaps, which can lead nowhere but to distress and grief when the child is called upon for the reserve strength that is not there because he has never met with the necessary resistance. It may seem like a trite statement, but it is nonetheless true on that account to say the only permanent good that can come to a child comes out of what he does for himself. The greatest service that can be rendered to any person on earth is the service which causes that person to rely upon himself. When you pitch a dime to the beggar, you may benefit him temporarily, but in the long run you have done him a decided injury because you have taken away from him the necessity of struggle. I met a man in Lawton, Oklahoma on my recent tour of the country who gave me much food for thought. I had ridden around with him all afternoon in an automobile before I learned that he was stone blind. His dark glasses covered his eyes, and not a sign of his affliction was to be seen on his face or detected from his voice. He laughingly carried on one of the most interesting conversations I have ever listened to, and entertained me so splendidly that I did not notice his blindness. Afterward, I learned of this man's early struggles. He had lost his eyes at the age of 4. Several years ago, he presented himself at Northwestern University in the city of Chicago for matriculation as a student. The officials refused to accept him, urging him not to undertake a stiff course such as tried the strength of able-bodied young men and women to the utmost. But this young fellow knew no defeat. He was persistent. Finally, the university officials asked him how much money he had with which to pay his way through school, and he replied, $35. They told him he would only be wasting his time to start in to try it. He went out and walked around the block a time or two, and then came back and said, "Now look here, let me enter for the first semester, and if I do not keep up with my classes and pay my way, you can turn me out." They consented largely, I suspect, because they did not have the heart to refuse. This young man not only completed the first semester with honors at the head of his classes, but he finished the entire course leading all the way through. But this is not all. He paid his way by taking notes in the lecture rooms, transcribing them on the typewriter, and selling copies to his fellow students, those who had two perfectly good eyes and money in the bank besides. Rarely does a person ever have opportunity to test the limits of his ability. We can accomplish pretty much whatever we make up our minds to accomplish. If we are not forced to test our strength through dire necessity, through struggle, through hardships, we seldom discover our possibilities. Lay it down as a general rule, and a sound one at that, that real strength comes from struggle, hardship, adversity, and handicaps imposed upon us by causes beyond our immediate control. If we could control these causes, they would not exist because we would eliminate them, thereby depriving ourselves of the most beneficial experience that can come to a human being. 20-odd years ago, I found myself forced to work as a laborer in the coal mines. Nothing short of necessity would have induced me to perform such work, Yet out of that very work came experience that has played and is now playing no small part in the very best service I have rendered and will continue to render my fellow men. We are in the midst of a great industrial crisis, not alone in America but throughout the world, and much of our effort is directed toward the elimination of the cause out of which this crisis grew. These efforts have not been without visible results, something that would not have been possible except for the forced service rendered in the coal mines years ago. This brought me close to the people who labor in those mines and gave me a splendid chance to study the conditions under which they word the grievances of which they complain, their faults and their virtues. Now, when I presume to write for or about those who perform the most lowly sort of labor, I write not as one whose hands were never covered with the grime and dust of honest toil, but as one who has worked shoulder to shoulder with these men whose voices are now crying out for justice and fair treatment. And when I send back the message to the laborers out of which ranks I came, urging them to perform more work and better work than actually paid for, I know that I am not leading them astray or counseling them unwisely, because it has been this one practice more than any other that has helped me throw off an undesirable, unprofitable environment and get into the work that I love. The reason why this is a sound practice is obvious. It develops greater and greater ability, and finally, a man just naturally bursts out of his cramped environment, attracting the attention of men in a more desirable walk of life. Out of effort and resistance comes strength. The greater the effort, the greater the compensating strength. And the man who foolishly withholds the best service he is capable of rendering, because he may not be receiving what it is worth, is only prolonging the time of failure. I know of no other single quality that has paid me greater dividends and carried me further toward my ultimate goal in life than is the habit of performing more service and better service than is actually paid for. But lay stress on that word habit. This practice must become a habit, and recognition must be gained before the real results begin to show. To merely perform better service than is paid for one day and refrain from doing it the other 5 working days of the week would be something like training 1 hour a week for a prize fight and resting the remainder of the time. Out of resistance comes strength. A man may be born to the weary treadmill of toil, but if he understands that out of toil, out of resistance, out of effort, out of adversity comes strength, he will not long remain a victim of this handicap. Instead, he will soon burst the cords of circumstances and environment, no matter how strong they may seem, and rise to claim his own that is born of struggle and hardship. A toast to the man who fails. As my fingers begin to play upon the keyboard of my typewriter, I look and see before me a great army of men whose faces show the lines of care and despair. Some are in rags, having reached the last stage of that long, long trail which all men fight to avoid, failure. Others are in better circumstances, but the fear of starvation shows plainly on their faces. The smile of courage has left their lips, and they, too, seem to have given up the fight. The scene shifts. I look again and am carried backward into the events of history past, and there I see also the failures of the past, failures which have meant more to the human race than all the successes recorded in the history of the world. I see the homely face of Socrates as he stood at the very end of that trail which men call failure, waiting with upturned eyes through those moments that must have seemed like an eternity just before he drank the poisoned hemlock. I see Christopher Columbus standing in a Spanish dungeon, a prisoner in chains, the tribute paid him for his sacrifice when he set sail on an unknown ocean to discover an unknown world, knowing that the chances were greatly in favor of his never returning to his native land. I see the face of Thomas Paine, the man whom the English sought to capture and put to death as the real instigator of the American Revolution. I see him lying in a filthy prison in France, waiting calmly under the shadow of the guillotine, a reprieve from death, in writing as he waited many pages dedicated to the advancement of human liberty. And I see also the face of the man from Galilee suffering on the cross at Calvary, the reward for his efforts to interest men in being decent with one another here on earth. Failures all. Oh, to be such a failure. Oh, to go down in history as these men did, as being brave enough to place humanity above the individual and principle above pecuniary gain. On such failures rest the hopes of the world. The test of a man. The measure of a real man is in his ability to see with clear eyes all the beauty and the good and all the injustice and the wrong there is in the world, and still maintain an even sense of proportion in all things toward all people. I bow to the man who can see the imperfections of mankind without becoming cynical, who can temper justice with mercy, who can see the good there is in men who disagree with him, who can work in harmony with those whom he does not admire, who exercises self-control and lets reason instead of emotion govern his actions toward others. Such a man was the immortal Lincoln. He was a man with a message when he had sufficient provocation to have become a man with a grievance instead. As reward for his greatness, the world has erected an everlasting monument to Lincoln's name, a monument that the elements can never disintegrate, that no depredating hand can destroy, a monument built in the heart of the people, built not of stone but of love, sympathy, patience, tolerance, and forgiveness for mankind. Those gentle qualities that memory attaches to his name and which are now the real test of a man. The damaging effects of subterfuge and deceit. Nothing really seems so very bad until someone tries to cover it up through subterfuge and deceit. We may not agree with the man who boldly admits his shortcomings, but we cannot withhold from him a certain healthy respect on account of his boldness. On the other hand, the moment a person resorts to secrecy or to subterfuge, even in connection with matters of small importance, that person becomes immediately marked as unworthy of trust. If there is a skeleton in the closet which is apt to crawl out to plague one of the most inopportune time, a mighty good plan is to voluntarily drag it out and say, "There it is, what are you going to do about it?" People will forgive most anything unless there is an attempt to cover it up and clothe it in secrecy. In that event, forgiveness comes reluctantly, if at all. Many a solid friend has been made by open frankness in connection with matters that, within themselves, were of small importance, while on the other hand, lifelong enemies have been made by lack of this frankness. If a person is secretive and resorts to deceit and subterfuge in small matters, the supposition is that in matters of greater import, the same tactics will prevail. Deliver more service and better service than you are paid for. This simple injunction comes from a man who started at the very bottom, in the most lowly sort of labor. It constitutes the keynote of almost every public address this man delivers. It permeates nearly everything he writes. It creeps into his everyday conversation. There are many reasons why this is sound counsel, only one of which need be mentioned. Namely, every person who forms the habit of delivering this sort of service soon attracts the attention of competitive bidders for his services. He stands out above the common crowd like a skyscraper above the ordinary buildings, and there is keen competition for his labor. Give the best service you know how to render, regardless of the amount you receive for it, and soon, much sooner than you might imagine, you will become a marked person, and greater responsibilities and higher wages will be thrusting themselves upon you. Deliver the best services you can, not necessarily out of consideration for the purchaser, but out of consideration for yourself. Failure to practice this habit is the chief obstacle that stands between 95% of the people and success. But of course, this does not apply to you, or does it? Aimlessness is a sin, and it leads straight to poverty, misery, want, and failure. A man without a definite, constructive purpose in life is simply one of nature's mistakes, because she did not intend to create such a being in all probability. Seven Remedies for a Lean Purse by George S. Clason. Note to the listener: the following story is a parable devised by Clason. His teaching method was to render financial advice in the form of mythical stories. The glory of Babylon endures. Down through the ages, its reputation comes to us as the richest of cities, its treasures as fabulous. Yet it was not always so. The riches of Babylon were the results of the money wisdom of its people. They first had to learn how to become wealthy. When the good king Sargon returned to Babylon after defeating his enemies, the Elamites, he was confronted with a serious situation. The royal chancellor explained it to the king thus: "After many years of great prosperity brought to our people because your majesty built the great irrigation canals and the mighty temples to the gods, now that these works are completed, the people seem unable to support themselves. The laborers are without employment. The merchants have few customers. The farmers are unable to sell their produce. The people have not enough gold to buy food. But where has all the gold gone that we spent for all these great improvements?" demanded the king. "It has found its way, I fear," responded the chancellor, "into the possession of a few very rich men of our city. It filtered through the fingers of most of our people as quickly as the goat's milk goes through the strainer. Now that the stream of gold has ceased to flow, most of our people have nothing to show for their earnings." The king was thoughtful for some time. Then he asked, "Why should so few men be able to acquire all the gold?" "Because they know how," replied the chancellor. "One may not condemn a man for succeeding because he knows how. Neither may one with justice take away from a man what he has fairly earned to give to men of less ability." "But why," demanded the king, "should not all the people learn how to accumulate gold and therefore become themselves rich and prosperous?" "Quite possible, Your Excellency. But who can teach them? Certainly not the priests, because they know naught of money-making." "Who knows best in all our city how to become wealthy, Chancellor?" asked the king. "Thy question answers itself, Your Majesty. Who has amassed the greatest wealth in Babylon?" "Well said, my able Chancellor. It is Arkad. He is the richest man in Babylon. Bring him before me on the morrow." Upon the following day, as the king had decreed, Arkad appeared before him, straight and sprightly despite his 80 years. "Arkad," spoke the king, "is it true thou art the richest man in Babylon?" "So it is reported, Your Majesty, and no man disputes it." "How became thou so wealthy?" "By taking advantage of opportunities available to all citizens of our good city." "Thou hadst nothing to start with?" "Only a great desire for wealth. Besides this, nothing." "Arkad," continued the king, "our city is in a very unhappy state because a few men know how to acquire wealth and therefore monopolize it, while the mass of our citizens lack the knowledge of how to keep any part of the gold they receive. It is my desire that Babylon be the wealthiest city in the world. Therefore, it must be a city of many wealthy men. Therefore, we must teach all the people how to acquire riches. Tell me, Arkad, is there any secret to acquiring wealth? Can it be taught?"
"It is practical, Your Majesty. That which one man knows can be taught to others." The king's eyes glowed.
"Arkad, thou speakest the words I wish to hear. Wilt thou lend thyself to this great cause? Wilt thou teach thy knowledge to a school for teachers, each of whom shall teach others, until there are enough trained to teach these truths to every worthy subject in my domain?" Arkad bowed and said, "I am thy humble servant to command. Whatever of knowledge I possess will I gladly give for the betterment of my fellow men and the glory of my king. Let your good chancellor arrange for me
a class of 100 men, and I will teach them those 7 remedies which did fatten my purse, than which there was none leaner in all Babylon. A fortnight later, in compliance with the king's command, the chosen 100 assembled in the great hall of the Temple of Learning, seated upon colorful rugs in a semicircle. Arkad sat beside a small tabaret upon which smoked a sacred lamp, sending forth a strange and pleasing odor. "Behold the richest man in Babylon," whispered a student, nudging his neighbor as Arkad rose. "He is but a man even as the rest of us."
"As a dutiful subject of our great king," Arkad began, "I stand before you in his service. Because once I was a poor youth who did greatly desire gold, and because I found knowledge that enabled me to acquire it, he asked that I impart unto you my knowledge. I started my fortune in the humblest way. I had no advantage not enjoyed as fully by you and every citizen of Babylon. The first storehouse of my treasure was a well-worn purse. I loathed its useless emptiness. I desired that it be round and full, clinking with the sound of gold. Therefore, I sought every remedy for a lean purse. I found 7. To you who are assembled before me, shall I explain the 7 remedies for a lean purse, which I do recommend to all men who desire much gold. Each day for 7 days will I explain to you 1 of the 7 remedies. Listen attentively to the knowledge that I will impart. Debate it with me. Discuss it among yourselves. Learn these lessons thoroughly, that you may also plant in your own purses the seed of wealth. First must each of you start wisely to build a fortune of his own. Then wilt thou be competent, and only then, to teach these truths to others. I shall teach you in simple ways how to fatten your purses. This is the first step leading to the temple of wealth, and no man may climb who cannot plant his feet firmly upon the first step. We shall now consider the first remedy. The first remedy: start thy purse to fattening. Arkad addressed a thoughtful man in the second row. "My good friend, at what craft workest thou?"
"I," replied the man, "am a scribe and carve records upon the clay tablets."
"Even at such labor did I myself earn my first coppers. Therefore thou hast the same opportunity to build a fortune." He spoke to a florid-faced man further back. "Pray tell also, what dost thou to earn thy bread?"
"I," responded this man, "am a meat butcher. I do buy the goats the farmers raise and kill them, and sell the meat to the housewives, and the hides to the sandal makers."
"Because thou dost also labor and earn, thou hast every advantage to succeed that I did possess." In this way did Arkad proceed to find out how each man labored to earn his living. When he had done questioning them, he said, "Now, my students, ye can see that there are many trades and labors at which men may earn coins. Each of the ways of earning is a stream of gold from which the worker doth divert by his labors a portion to his own purse. Therefore, into the purse of each of you flows a stream of coins, large or small, according to his ability. Is it not so?" Thereupon they agreed that it was so. "Then," continued Arkad, "if each of you desireth to build for himself a fortune, is it not wise to start by utilizing that source of wealth which he already has established?" To this they agreed. Then Arkad turned to a humble man who had declared himself an egg merchant. "If thou select one of thy baskets and put into it each morning 10 eggs, and take out from it each evening 9 eggs, what will eventually happen?"
"It will become in time overflowing."
"Why?"
"Because each day I put in 1 more egg than I take out."
Arkad turned to the class with a smile. "Does any man here have a lean purse?" First they looked amused. Then they laughed. Lastly, they waved their purses in jest. "All right," he continued. "Now I shall tell thee the first remedy I learned to cure a lean purse. Do exactly as I have suggested to the egg merchant. For every 10 coins thou placest within thy purse,
take out for use but 9. Thy purse will start to fatten at once, and its increasing weight will feel good in thy hand, and bring satisfaction to thy soul. Deride not what I say because of its simplicity. Truth is always simple. I told thee I would tell how I built my fortune. This was my beginning. I too carried a lean purse and cursed it, because there was naught within to satisfy my desires. But when I began to take out from my purse but 9 parts of 10 I put in, it began to fatten. So will thine. Now I will tell a strange truth, the reason for which I know not. When I ceased to pay out more than 9/10 of my earnings, I managed to get along just as well. I was not shorter than before. Also, ere long, did coins come to me more easily than before. Surely it is a law of the gods that unto him who keepeth and spendeth not a certain part of all his earnings, shall gold come more easily. Likewise, him whose purse is empty, does gold void. Which desirest thou the most? Is it the gratification of thy desires of each day? A jewel, a bit of finery, better raiment, more food, things quickly gone and forgotten? Or is it substantial belongings, gold, lands, herds, merchandise, income-bringing investment? The coins thou takest from thy purse bring the first. The coins thou leaveth within it will bring the latter. This, my students, was the first remedy I did discover for my lean purse. For each 10 coins I put in, to spend but 9. Debate this amongst yourselves. If any man proves it untrue, tell me upon the morrow when we shall meet again. The second remedy. Control thy expenditures. Some of your members, my students, have asked me this. How can a man keep 1/10 of all he earns in his purse when all the coins he earns are not enough for his necessary expenses? So did Arkad address his students upon the second day. Yesterday, how many of thee carried lean purses? All of us, answered the class. Yet thou do not all earn the same. Some earn much more than others. Some have much larger families to support. Yet all purses were equally lean. Now I will tell thee an unusual truth about men and sons of men. It is this, that what each of us calls our necessary expenses will always grow to equal our incomes unless we protest to the contrary. Confuse not thy necessary expenses with thy desires. Each of you, together with your good families, have more desires than your earnings can gratify. Therefore, are thy earnings spent to gratify these desires insofar as they will go? Still thou retainest many ungratified desires. All men are burdened with more desires than they can gratify. Because of my wealth, thinkest thou I may gratify every desire? 'Tis a false idea. There are limits to my time. There are limits to my strength. There are limits to the distance I may travel. There are limits to what I may eat. There are limits to the zest with which I may enjoy. I say to you that just as weeds grow in a field wherever the farmer leaves space for their roots, even so freely do desires grow in men whenever there is a possibility of their being gratified. Thy desires are a multitude, and those that thou mayest gratify are but few. Study thoughtfully thy accustomed habits of living. Herein may be most often found certain accepted expenses that may wisely be reduced or eliminated. Let thy motto be 100% of appreciated value demanded for each coin spent. Therefore, engrave upon the clay each thing for which thou desireth to spend. Select those that are necessary and others that are possible through the expenditures of 9/10 of thy income. Cross out the rest, and consider them but a part of that great multitude of desires that must go unsatisfied, and regret them not. Budget then thy necessary expenses. Touch not the 1/10 that is fattening thy purse. Let this be thy great desire that is being fulfilled. Keep working with thy budget. Keep adjusting it to help thee. Make it thy first assistant in defending thy fattening purse. Hereupon one of the students, wearing a robe of red and gold, arose and said, "I am a free man. I believe that it is my right to enjoy the good things of life. Therefore do I rebel against the slavery of a budget, which determines just how much I may spend and for what. I feel it would take much pleasure from my life and make me little more than a pack ass to carry a burden." To him, Arcad replied, "Who, my friend, would determine thy budget?"
"I would make it for myself," responded the protesting one.
"In that case, were a pack ass to budget his burden, would he include therein jewels and rugs and heavy bars of gold?"
"Not so. He would include hay and grain and a bag of water for the desert trail.
The purpose of a budget is to help thy purse to fatten. It is to assist thee to have thy necessities, and insofar as attainable, thy other desires. It is to enable thee to realize thy most cherished desires by defending them from thy casual wishes. Like a bright light in a dark cave, thy budget shows up the leaks from thy purse and enables thee to stop them and control thy expenditures for definite and gratifying purposes. This, then, is the second remedy for a lean purse. Budget thy expenses that thou mayest have coins to pay for thy necessities, to pay for thy enjoyments, and to gratify thy worthwhile desires without spending more than 9/10 of thy earnings. The third remedy. Make thy gold multiply. Behold, thy lean purse is fattening. Thou hast disciplined thyself to leave therein 1/10 of all thou earneth. Thou hast controlled thy expenditures to protect thy growing treasure. Next, we will consider means to put thy treasure to labor and to increase. Gold in a purse is gratifying to own and satisfieth a miserly soul, but earns nothing. The gold we may retain from our earnings is but the start. The earnings it will make shall build our fortunes. So spoke Arcad upon the third day to his class. How, therefore, may we put our gold to work? My first investment was unfortunate, for I lost all. Its tale I will relate later. My first profitable investment was a loan I made to a man named Agar, a shield maker. Once each year did he buy large shipments of bronze brought from across the sea to use in his trade. Lacking sufficient capital to pay the merchants, he would borrow from those who had extra coins. He was an honorable man. His borrowing he would repay, together with a liberal rental as he sold his shields. Each time I loaned to him, I loaned back also the rental he had paid to me. Therefore, not only did my capital increase, but its earning likewise increased. Most gratifying was it to have these sums returned to my purse. I tell you, my students, a man's wealth is not in the coins he carries in his purse. It is in the income he buildeth, the golden stream that continually floweth into his purse and keepeth it always bulging. That is what every man desireth. That is what thou, each one of thee, desireth, an income that continueth to come whether thou work or travel. Great income I have acquired, so great that I am called a very rich man. My loans to Agar were my first training in profitable investment. Gaining wisdom from his experience, I extended my loans and investments as my capital increased. From a few sources at first, from many sources later, flowed into my purse a golden stream of wealth available for such wise uses as I should decide. Behold, from my humble earnings, I had begotten a horde of golden slaves, each laboring and earning more gold. As they labored for me, so their children also labored, and their children's children, until great was the income from their combined efforts. Gold increaseth rapidly when making reasonable earnings, as thou wilt see from the following. A farmer, when his first son was born, took 10 pieces of silver to a moneylender and asked him to keep it on rental for his son until he became 20 years of age. This the moneylender did, and agreed the rental should be 1/4 of its value each 4 years. The farmer asked, because this sum he had set aside as belonging to his son, that the rental be added to the principal. When the boy had reached the age of 20 years, the farmer again went to the moneylender to inquire about the silver. The moneylender explained that because the sum had been increased by compound interest,
The original 10 pieces of silver had now grown to 30 1/2 pieces. The farmer was well pleased, and because the son did not need the coins, he left them with the moneylender. When the son became 50 years of age, the father meantime having passed to the other world, the moneylender paid the son in settlement 167 pieces of silver. Thus, in 50 years had the investment multiplied itself at rental almost 17 times. This, then, is the third remedy for a lean purse: to put each coin to laboring that it may reproduce its kind even as the flocks of the field, and help bring to thee income, a stream of wealth that shall flow constantly into thy purse. The fourth remedy: guard thy treasures from loss. Misfortune loves a shining mark. Gold in a man's purse must be guarded with firmness, else it be lost. Thus it is wise that we must first secure small amounts and learn to protect them before the gods entrust us with larger. So spoke Arcad upon the fourth day to his class. Every owner of gold is tempted by opportunities whereby it would seem that he could make large sums by its investment in most plausible projects. Often friends and relatives are eagerly entering each investment and urge him to follow. The first sound principle of investment is security for thy principal. Is it wise to be intrigued by larger earnings when thy principal may be lost? I say not. The penalty of risk is probable loss. Study carefully before parting with the treasure each assurance that it may be safely reclaimed. Be not misled by thy own romantic desires to make wealth rapidly. Before thou loan it to any man, assure thyself of his ability to repay and his reputation for doing so, that thou mayest not unwittingly by making him a present of thy hard-earned treasure. Before thou entrust it as an investment in any field, acquaint thyself with the dangers which may beset it. My own first investment was a tragedy to me at the time. The guarded savings of a year I did entrust to a brickmaker named Osmore, who was traveling over the far seas, and in Tyre agreed to buy for me the rare jewels of the Phoenicians. These we would sell upon his return and divide the profits. The Phoenicians were scoundrels and sold him bits of glass. My treasure was lost. Today my training would show me at once the folly of entrusting a brickmaker to buy jewels. Therefore do I advise thee from the wisdom of my experiences: be not too confident of thy own wisdom in entrusting thy treasures to the possible pitfalls of investments. Better far consult the wisdom of those experienced in handling money for profit. Such advice is freely given for the asking, and may readily possess a value equal in gold to the sum thou considerest investing. In truth, such is its actual value if it save thee from loss. This, then, is the fourth remedy for a lean purse, and of great importance if it prevent thy purse from being emptied once it has become well filled. Guard thy treasure from loss by investing only where thy principal is safe, where it may be reclaimed if desirable, and where thou wilt not fail to collect a fair rental. Consult with wise men. Secure the advice of men experienced in the profitable handling of gold. Let their wisdom protect thy treasure from unsafe investment. The fifth remedy: make of thy dwelling a profitable investment. If a man setteth aside 9 parts of his earnings upon which to live and enjoy life, and if any part of this 9 parts he can turn into a profitable investment without detriment to his well-being, then so much faster will his treasures grow. So spake Arcad to his class at their fifth lesson. All too many of our men of Babylon do raise their families in unseemly quarters. They do pay to exacting landlords liberal rentals for rooms where their wives have not a spot to raise the blooms that gladden a woman's heart, and their children have no place to play their games except in the unclean alleys. No man's family can fully enjoy life unless they do have a plot of ground wherein children can play in the clean earth, and where the wife may raise not only blossoms, but good rich herbs to feed her family.
To a man's heart it brings gladness to eat the figs from his own trees and the grapes of his own vines. To own his own domicile, and to have it a place he is proud to care for, putteth confidence in his heart, and greater effort behind all his endeavors. Therefore do I recommend that every man own the roof that sheltereth him and his. Nor is it beyond the ability of any well-intentioned man to own his home. Hath not our great king so widely extended the walls of Babylon, that within them much land is now unused, and may be purchased at sums most reasonable? Also I say to you, my students, that the moneylenders gladly consider the desires of men who seek homes and lands for their families. Readily may thou borrow to pay the brickmaker and the builder for such commendable purposes, if thou can show a reasonable portion of the necessary sum which thou thyself hath provided for the purpose. Then when the house be built, thou canst pay the moneylender with the same regularity as thou didst pay the landlord, because each payment will reduce thy indebtedness to the moneylender. A few years will satisfy his loan. Then wilt thy heart be glad, because thou wilt own in thy own right a valuable property, and thy only cost will be the king's taxes. Also wilt thy good wife go more often to the river, to wash thy robes, that each time returning she may bring a goatskin of water to pour upon the growing things. Thus come many blessings to the man who owneth his own house, and greatly will it reduce his cost of living, making available more of his earnings for pleasures and the gratification of his desires. This, then, is the fifth remedy for a lean purse. Own thy own home. The sixth remedy. Ensure a future income. The life of every man proceedeth from his childhood to his old age. This is the path of life, and no man may deviate from it unless the gods call him prematurely to the world beyond. Therefore do I say that it behooves a man to make preparation for a suitable income in the days to come, when he is no longer young, and to make preparations for his family should he be no longer with them, to comfort and support them. This lesson shall instruct thee in providing a full purse when time has made thee less able to earn. So Arcad addressed his class upon the sixth day. The man who, because of his understanding of the laws of wealth, acquireth a growing surplus, should give thought to those future days. He should plan certain investments or provisions that may endure safely for many years, yet will be available when the time arrives which he has so wisely anticipated. There are diverse ways by which a man may provide with safety for his future. He may provide a hiding place and there bury a secret treasure. Yet, no matter with what skill it be hidden, it may nevertheless become the loot of thieves. For this reason, I recommend not this plan. A man may buy houses or lands for this purpose. If wisely chosen as to their usefulness and value in the future, they are permanent in their value, and their earnings or their sale will provide well for his purpose. A man may loan a small sum to the moneylender and increase it at regular periods. The rental which the moneylender adds to this will largely add to its increase. I do know a sandal maker named Onsen who explained to me not long ago that each week for 8 years, he had deposited with his moneylender 2 pieces of silver. The moneylender had but recently given him an accounting over which he greatly rejoiced. The total of his small deposits with their rental at the customary rate of 1/4 their value for each 4 years had now become 1,040 pieces of silver. I did gladly encourage him further by demonstrating to him, with my knowledge of the numbers, that in 12 years more, if he would keep his regular deposits of but 2 pieces of silver each week, the moneylender would then owe him 4,000 pieces of silver, a worthy competence for the rest of his life. Surely when such a small payment made with regularity doth produce such profitable results, no man can afford not to ensure a treasure for his old age and the protection of his family, no matter how prosperous his business and his investments may be. I would that I might say more about this. In my mind rests the belief
that someday wise-thinking men will devise a plan to ensure men against death, whereby many men pay in but a trifling sum regularly, the aggregate making a handsome sum for the family of each member who passeth to the beyond. This do I see as something desirable, and which I could highly recommend. But today it is not possible, because it must reach beyond the life of any man or any partnership to operate. It must be as stable as the king's throne. Some day do I feel that such a plan shall come to pass, and be a great blessing to many men, because even the first small payment will make available a snug fortune for the family of a member should he pass on. But because we live in our own day, and not in the days which are to come, we must take advantage of those means and ways of accomplishing our purposes. Therefore do I recommend to all men that they, by wise and well thought out methods, do provide against a lean purse in their mature years. For a lean purse to a man no longer able to earn, or to a family without its head, is a sore tragedy. This, then, is the sixth remedy for a lean purse. Provide in advance for the needs of thy growing age and the protection of thy family. The seventh remedy: increase thy ability to earn. This day do I speak to thee, my students, of one of the most vital remedies for a lean purse. Yet I will talk not of gold, but of yourselves, of the men beneath the robes of many colors who do sit before me. I will talk to you of those things within the minds and lives of men which do work for or against their success. So did Arcad address his class upon the seventh day. Not long ago came to me a young man seeking to borrow. When I questioned him the cause of his necessity, he complained that his earnings were insufficient to pay his expenses. Thereupon I explained to him, this being the case, he was a poor customer for the moneylender, as he possessed no surplus earning capacity to repay the loan. What you need, young man, I told him, is to earn more coins. What dost thou to increase thy capacity to earn? All that I can do, he replied. 6 times within 2 moons have I approached my master to request my pay be increased, but without success. No man can go oftener than that. We may smile at his simplicity, yet he did possess one of the vital requirements to increase his earnings. Within him was a strong desire to earn more, a proper and commendable desire. Preceding accomplishment must be desire. Thy desires must be strong and definite. General desires are but weak longings. For a man to wish to be rich is of little purpose. For a man to desire 5 pieces of gold is a tangible desire which he can press to fulfillment. After he has backed his desire for 5 pieces of gold with strength of purpose to secure it, next he can find similar ways to obtain 10 pieces, and then 20 pieces, and later 1,000 pieces, and behold, he has become wealthy. In learning to secure his one definite small desire, he hath trained himself to secure a larger one. This is the process by which wealth is accumulated, first in small sums, then in larger ones, as a man learns and becomes more capable. Desires must be simple and definite. They defeat their own purpose should they be too many, too confusing, or beyond the training to accomplish. As a man perfecteth himself in his calling, even so doth his ability to earn increase. In those days when I was a humble scribe, carving upon the clay for a few coppers each day, I observed that other workers did more than I, and were paid more. Therefore did I determine that I would be exceeded by none, nor did it take long for me to discover the reason for their greater success. More interest in my work, more concentration upon my task, more persistence in my effort, and behold, few men could carve more tablets in a day than I. With reasonable promptness, my increased skill was rewarded, nor was it necessary for me to go 6 times to my master to request recognition. The more of wisdom we know, the more we may earn. That man who seeks to learn more of his craft
shall be richly rewarded. If he is an artisan, he may seek to learn the methods and the tools of those most skillful in the same line. If he laboreth at the law or at healing, he may consult and exchange knowledge with others of his calling. If he be a merchant, he may continually seek better goods that can be purchased at lower prices. Always do the affairs of man change and improve, because keen-minded men seek greater skill, that they may better serve those upon whose patronage they depend. Therefore, I urge all men to be in the front rank of progress, and not to stand still, lest they be left behind. Many things come to make a man's life rich with gainful experiences. Such things as the following, a man must do if he shall respect himself. He must pay his debts with all promptness within his power, not purchasing that for which he is unable to pay. He must take care of his family, that they may think and speak well of him. He must make a will of record that in case the gods call him, proper and honorable division of his property be accomplished. He must have compassion upon those who are injured or smitten by misfortune, and aid them within reasonable limits. He must do deeds of thoughtfulness to those dear to him. Thus the seventh and last remedy for a lean purse is to cultivate thy own powers, to study and become more skillful, to so act as to respect thyself. Thereby shalt thou acquire confidence in thyself to achieve thy carefully considered desires. These then are the seven remedies for a lean purse, which out of the experience of a long and successful life, I do urge for all men who desire wealth. There is more gold in Babylon, my students, than thou dreamest of. There is abundance for all. Go thou forth and practice these truths, that thou mayest prosper and grow wealthy, as is thy right. Go thou forth and teach these truths, that every honorable subject of His Majesty may also share liberally in the ample wealth of our beloved city. This is thy king's command. After Failure, What? By Orson Swett Marden. A great many people never really discover themselves until ruin stares them in the face. They do not seem to know how to bring out their reserves until they are overtaken by an overwhelming disaster, or until the sight of their blighted prospects and of the wreck of their homes and happiness stirs them to the very center of their beings. The real test of character is what a man does after he fails. What will he do next? What resources, what inventiveness will his failure arouse in him? Will it discover new sources of power? Will it bring out reserves, double his determination, or will it dishearten him? I know no such unquestionable badger and ensign of a sovereign mind, said Emerson, as that tenacity of purpose which, through all changes of companions, or parties, or fortunes, changes never, bates no jot of heart or hope, but wearies out opposition and arrives at its port. To come up again and wrest triumph from defeat, that is the secret of the success of every brave and noble life that ever was lived. A little boy was asked how he learned to skate. Oh, by getting up every time I fell down, he replied. This is the spirit that leads men and armies to victory. It is not the fall, but the not getting up that is defeat. Perhaps the past has been a bitter disappointment to you. In looking it over, you may feel that you have been plodding along in mediocrity. You may not have succeeded in the particular things you expected to succeed in, or you may have lost friends and relatives who were very dear to you. You may have lost your business, and even your home may have been wrenched from you because you could not pay the mortgage on it, or because of sickness and consequent inability to work. The new year may present a very discouraging outlook to you. Yet, in spite of any or all of these misfortunes, if you refuse to be conquered, victory is awaiting you further on the road. This is the test of your manhood. How much is there left in you after you have lost everything outside of yourself? If you lie down now, throw up your hands, and acknowledge yourself worsted,
there is not much in you. But if, with heart undaunted and face turned forward, you refuse to give up or to lose faith in yourself, if you scorn to beat a retreat, you will show that the man left in you is bigger than your loss, greater than your cross, and larger than any defeat. You may say that you have failed too often, that there is no use in trying, that it is impossible for you to succeed, and that it is useless for you even to attempt to get on your feet again. Nonsense! There is no failure for a man whose spirit is unconquered. No matter how late the hour, or how many and repeated his failures, success is still possible. The evolution of Scrooge the miser in the closing years of his life, from a hard, narrow, heartless money grubber whose soul was imprisoned in his shining heap of hoarded gold, to a generous, genial lover of his kind, is no mere myth of Dickens' brain. Time and again, in the history of our daily lives, chronicled in our newspapers, recorded in biographies, or exhibited before our eyes, we see men and women redeeming past failures, rising up out of the stupor of discouragement, and boldly turning face forward once more. There are thousands of people who have lost everything they had in the world, who are just as far from failure as they were before their loss, because of their unconquerable spirit, stout hearts that never quail. In true manhood, there is something which rises higher than worldly success or failure. No matter what reverses come to him, what disappointments or failures, a really great man rises superior to them. He never loses his equanimity. In the midst of storms and trials to which a weak nature would succumb, his serene soul, his calm confidence still assert themselves, so completely dominating all outward conditions that they have no power to harm him. "What is defeat?" says Wendell Phillips. "Nothing but the first steps to something higher. Many a one has finally succeeded only because he has failed after repeated efforts. If he had never met defeat, he would never have known any great victory. There is something in defeat which puts new determination into a man of mettle. No, there is no failure for the man who realizes his power, who never knows when he is beaten. There is no failure for the determined endeavor, the unconquerable will. There is no failure for the man who gets up every time he falls, who rebounds like a rubber ball, who persists when everyone else gives up, who pushes on when everyone else turns back." Light on Life's Difficulties by James Allen. I, Truth, am thy Redeemer, come to me. Lay down thy sin and pain in wild unrest, and I will calm thy spirit's stormy sea, pouring the oil of peace upon thy breast. Friendless and lone, lo, I abide with thee. Defeated and deserted, cast away, what refuge hast thou? Whither canst thou fly? Upon my changeless breast thy burdens lay. I am thy certain refuge, even I. All things are passing, I alone can stay. Lo, I, the great forsaken, am the friend of the forsaken, I, whom men despise. The weak, the helpless, and despised defend. I gladden aching hearts and weeping eyes. Rest thou in me, I am thy sorrow's end. Lovers and friends and wealth, pleasures and fame, these fail and change and pass into decay. But my love does not change, and in thy blame I blame thee not, nor turn my face away. In my calm bosom hide thy sin and shame. Forward. When a man enters a dark room, he is not sure of his movements. He cannot see the objects around or properly locate them, and is liable to hurt himself by coming into sudden contact with them. But let a light be introduced, and immediately all confusion disappears. Every object is seen, and there is no more danger of being hurt. To the majority, life is such a dark room, and their frequent hurts, their disappointments, perplexities, sorrows, and pains, are caused by sudden contact with principles which they do not see, and are therefore not prepared to deal with.
But when the light of wisdom is introduced into the darkened understanding, confusion vanishes, difficulties are dissolved, all things are seen in their true place and proportion, and henceforth the man walks open-eyed and unhurt in the clear light of a wise comprehension. James Allen, Bryngelu, Ilfracombe, England. The Light That Leads to Perfect Peace. This audiobook is intended to be a strong and kingly companion, as well as a source of spiritual renewal and inspiration to those who aim at a life well-lived and made strong and serene. It will help its listeners to transform themselves into the ideal character they would wish to be, and to make their life here that blessed thing which the majority only hope for in some future life. Our life is what we make it by our own thoughts and deeds. It is our own state and attitude of mind which determine whether we are happy or unhappy, strong or weak, sinful or holy, foolish or wise. If one is unhappy, that state of mind belongs to himself and is originated within himself. It is a state which responds to certain outward happenings, but its cause lies within and not in those outward occurrences. If one is weak in will, he has brought himself to and remains in that condition by the course of thought and action which he has chosen and is still choosing. If one is sinful, it is because he has committed and continues to commit sinful acts. If he is foolish, it is because he himself does foolish things. A man has no character, no soul, no life apart from his thoughts and deeds. What they are, that he is. As they are modified, so does he change. He is endowed with will and can modify his character. As the carpenter changes the block of wood into a beautiful piece of furniture, so can the erring and sin-stricken man change himself into a wise and truth-loving being. Each man is responsible for the thoughts which he thinks and the acts which he does for his state of mind and the life which he lives. No power, no event, no circumstance can compel a man to evil and unhappiness. He himself is his own compeller. He thinks and acts by his own volition. No being, however wise and great, not even the Supreme, can make him good and happy. He himself must choose the good and thereby find the happy. And because of this, that when a man wishes and wills, he can find the good and the true and enjoy its bliss and peace, there is eternal gladness in the courts of truth and holy joy amongst the perfect ones. The gates of heaven are forever open, and no one is prevented from entering by any will or power but his own. But no one can enter the kingdom of heaven so long as he is enamored of and chooses the seductions of hell, so long as he resigns himself to sin and sorrow. There is a larger, higher, nobler, diviner life than that of sinning and suffering, which is so common, in which indeed nearly all are immersed, a life of victory over sin and triumph over evil, a life wise and happy, benign and tranquil, virtuous and peaceful. This life can be found and lived now, and he who lives it is steadfast in the midst of change, restful among the restless, peaceful though surrounded by strife. Should death confront him, he is calm. Though assailed by persecution, he knows no bitterness, and his heart is compassionate and filled with rejoicing. In this supremely beautiful life there is no evil, sin and sorrow are ended, and aching hearts and weeping eyes are no more. This life of triumph is not for those who are satisfied with any lower conditions, it is for those who thirst of it and are willing to achieve it, who are as eager for righteousness as the miser is for gold. It is always at hand and is offered to all, and blessed are they who accept and embrace it. They will enter the world of truth. They will find the perfect peace. Light on Facts and Hypotheses. When freedom of thought and freedom of expression abound, there is much controversy and much confusion. Yet it is from such controversial confusion that the simple facts of life emerge, attracting us with their eternal uniformity and harmony,
and appealing forcibly to us with their invisible simplicity and truth. We are living in such an age of freedom and mental conflict. Never were religious sects so numerous. Schools, philosophical, occult, and otherwise, abound, and each is eager for the perpetuation and dominance of its own explanation of the universe. The world is in a condition of mental ferment. Contradiction has reached the point of confusion so that the earnest seeker for truth can find no solid rock of refuge in the opposing systems which are presented to him, and is thereby thrown back upon himself, upon those incontrovertible facts of his own being which are ever with him, which are indeed himself, his life. Controversy is ranged around hypotheses, not around facts. Fact is fixed and final. Hypothesis is variable and vanishing. In his present stage of development, man is not alive to the beautiful simplicity of facts, nor to the power of satisfaction which is inherent in them. He does not perceive the intrinsic loveliness of truth, but must add something to it. Hence, when a fact is named, the question almost invariably arises, how can you explain the fact? And then follows a hypothesis which leads to another hypothesis, and so on, until the fact is altogether lost sight of amid a mass of contradictory suppositions. Thus arise the sects and controversial schools. The clear perception of one fact will lead to the perception of other facts, but a supposition, while appearing to elucidate a fact, does in reality cover it up. We cannot realize the stately splendor of truth while playing with the gaudy and attractive toys of pretty hypotheses. Truth is not an opinion, nor can any opinion enlarge or adorn it. Fact and supposition are eternally separate, and the cleverest intellectual jugglery, while it may entertain and deceive even the elect, cannot in the slightest degree alter a fact or affect the future of things as they are. Because of this, the true teacher abandons the devious path of hypothesis and deals only with the simple facts of life, fixing the attention of men upon these, instead of increasing confusion and intensifying wordy warfare by foisting another assumption upon a world already lost and bewildered in a maze of hypotheses. The facts of life are ever before us and can be understood and known if we but abandon our egotism and the blinding delusions which that egotism creates. Man need not go beyond his own being to find wisdom, and the facts of that being afford a sufficient basis on which to erect a temple of knowledge of such beauty and dimensions that it shall at once emancipate and glorify. Man is, and as he thinks, so he is. A perception and realization of these two facts alone, of man's being and thinking, lead into a vast avenue of knowledge which cannot stop short of the highest wisdom and perfection. One of the reasons why men do not become wise is that they occupy themselves with interminable speculations about a soul separate from themselves, that is, from their own mind, and so blind themselves to their actual nature and being. The supposition of a separate soul veils the eyes of man so that he does not see himself, does not know his mentality, is unaware of the nature of his thoughts, without which he would have no conscious life. Man's life is actual, his thoughts are actual, his life is actual. To occupy ourselves with the investigation of things that are is the way of wisdom. Man considered as above, beyond, and separate from mind and thought is speculative and not actual, and to occupy ourselves with the study of things that are not is the way of folly. Man cannot be separated from his mind. His life cannot be separated from his thoughts. Mind, thought, and life are as inseparable as light, radiance, and color, and are no more in need of another factor to elucidate them than are light, radiance, and color. The facts are all sufficient and contain within themselves the groundwork of all knowledge concerning them. Man, as mind, is subject to change. He is not something made and finally complete, but has within him the capacity for progress. By the universal law of evolution, he has become what he is and is becoming that which he will be. His being is modified by every thought he thinks. Every experience affects his character. Every effort he makes changes his mentality.
Herein is the secret of man's degradation and also of his power and salvation if he but utilize this law of change in the right choice of thought. To live is to think and act, and to think and act is to change.